Well, happy Thursday, everyone, and welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all, please do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And please make sure that you like the video on your way in the door. If you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter. So, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, better known as the Speakeasy Backyard Gang, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love me. All right. Now, let me see who is here, honey, so we can get on down the road, because listen, I'm so damn nosy, child. If it hadn't been for a phone conversation last night, child, I ain't gonna lie, I probably would have reared ahead a little bit, just a little bit. At least I'm being honest. I'm honest. Right, no T, just a whole bunch of S's. I'm real honest. Mm-hmm. All right, so, because I need to know what's going on. This book has got me, and I don't even know why. It's got me, though. Hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. First sipper and speaker in the building is Emir K. I've seen you before. I've seen you in the replay. Either that or I think I saw you requesting to follow me on Instagram. Either way, welcome, child. Y'all welcome, Emir, to the Speakeasy. But you got to tell me, are you male or female? How do you identify? Because I don't want to be like, hey, girl, hey, and then, you know, you got a whole penis in between your legs and identify as male. So you let me know what's up, but welcome. Anyway, hey, Demo, welcome, boo, and you too, wifey. Hey, Shakayla, welcome, welcome. Let me see. Hold on, I'm scrolling. Child, this thing is moving because people is talking. All right, let me see. There we go. Hey, Marva, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Let me see. I'm going. Hey, Fancy Danny, welcome back, darling. Thank you for being here. Let me see. Nope. Hey, Naja, welcome, welcome. I'm going. Hey, D. Reed, welcome. Thank you for being here as well. Okay, you are a male. I'm a male, but you do you. Okay. I don't know what happened. I thought I approved you because I remember seeing the avatar. I don't know. Try it again. Because, listen, Instagram be kicking folks off my page. Then it don't be letting me post. It's just raggedy. That's all I can say. Did I get you, D-Reed, child? I don't know. But if I didn't, hey, girl, hey. All right, there we go. All right, let me get my timestamp, child, because I got to get my nosy ass on down the road. I need to know. But send another request, Emir. Okay. Where in the world? Hey, church lady. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, I'm getting my timestamp. Okay, let me see if I see it. I don't see it yet. Yeah, I don't see it. What in the world? Okay. Anyway, we just got to wait for this thing to count down, honey. And then we can get on down the road because I'm not going to fool around. Got to wait for the notifications. Buck, who likes to fuck? Sliding in at the last second. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Oh my God. Oh my goodness. Child, listen. I had to sneeze and I think my whole face just flew out the window. Good googly moogly. What is going on? All of these trees, y'all, the shit is just flying through the air with the greatest of ease.
damn, I just like, what the hell? So, hey, Buck, welcome, welcome. And hey, Pearl, thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. All right, so I blew past that damn. Oh, Lord. All right, so y'all just hang on a few more seconds, y'all, because that timestamp was blown through like I don't know what. All right. All right, here we go. Chapter 26. This day could not get any worse for Malachi. He'd agonized and lamented over Leah the entire way to the airport, forcing the images of her dead body out of his mind repeatedly. He almost turned back to her apartment at least three times, but he kept chickening out, because he a bitch, sorry, reasoning that he had no way of explaining why he would be there without looking suspicious. Plus, he had deleted all traces of himself from her phone while he was there, then made sure there were no traces of her on his phone either when he got to the airport. All right, so he real dumb, right? Because he don't think that they got a record of the shit at the mobile carrier's office and that the text messages and shit ain't all up and through their servers. This stick is slow. All right, anyway. Best thing and worst thing you can have in your pocket is a goddamn cell phone. I promise you. They will find your ass, okay? All right. It was a flimsy cover-up. He knew it. Malachi had watched enough crime shows to know that deleting messages only could make matters worse if you were a suspect. He prayed Leah hadn't mentioned him to any of her family or friends. When he went to check in for his flight, things went from bad to worse. "I'm sorry, sir, that flight has been canceled because of a storm." Malachi couldn't believe his ears. "Canceled? Is there another one anytime soon?" She shot him a thin-lipped smile. "Not till morning." Malachi weighed his options as his conscience and paranoia continued to bear down on him. He shouldn't have left that woman at her apartment like that. What if none of her neighbors noticed the door open until her body started decomposing? Worse, what if a close friend or family member happened to stop by and found her like that? He would never want to see someone he loved in that position. He should have called the police. "Sir?" the attendant asked, breaking him from his thoughts. "Yeah, I'm sorry, you were saying?" She sighed. "I was saying, was there anything else I could do for you? Did you want me to see if I can squeeze you into one of the morning flights?" Malachi didn't like this. He didn't like this situation at all. "No, I'm just gonna cancel the trip." She paused. "Okay." Malachi didn't know if he was a fool or what, but he went through with canceling the whole trip. Maybe the storm was God's way of telling him he shouldn't be leaving town right now. Wait, his mind said as the wheels continued turning. What if the Avenger had sent him a photo of Leia the other day with another threat? Malachi had brushed it off. What if the Avenger killed Leia? He felt like a damn fool as reality dawned on him. This situation was getting too real. If the Avenger was able to kill Leia like that, there was no telling what they would be willing to do to him. He had to get out of the airport and figure out a plan. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. I don't even... Let me tell you something. This man is dumb, y'all. He real fucking stupid. I don't even know what to say. He just dumb, okay? Just deal with it. Anyway, Malachi didn't want to go home just yet, so he decided to head to Ben's house to see if he and Zaire were there. He had half a mind to tell them what was going on with him, but the other part of him was too afraid. What if one of them ratted him out to the police or tried to convince him to turn himself in? Chill, bro. You're being para. Malachi stopped his sentence as he whipped his head to the right. He could have sworn he'd just seen Chartage's car turning off of Ben's street. He banged a U-turn and tried to follow her, but she was long gone. What the hell was Chartage doing over here? He racked his brains. Malachi knew for a fact that Chartage didn't have any family or friends who lived near Ben. What was going on? Chill, bruh, he repeated, shaking himself out of his nerves. It could just be a coincidence. A coincidence? On the same night Leia gets murdered? Now he felt stupid. He thought he'd already ruled Chartage out as a suspect, but then again, she was acting kind of suspicious when they were at the police station about Makai's stalker. What if Chartage had deleted the messages from Makai's tablet? What if she staged the whole thing to make the possible heat off of herself? If she was planning to kill Leia, it made sense. Malachi would never suspect her if the Avenger had come for her first. He pulled back down Ben Street, then stopped in front of his house. Zaire's car was outside. Do I really want to go in here? He'd been avoiding his friends lately, ignoring most of their calls and messages. They'd only been trying to comfort him, but he didn't want to be feeling emotional all the time. He finally decided to just go in, since he'd driven here anyway. If things got too uncomfortable, he would leave. Malachi knocked and Ben answered. Hey, he said, assessing his friend. I thought you were going out of town. Malachi had told Ben and Zaire the same lie he told Zoe, that he was going out of town for a sanitation convention. They canceled it. Ben stared at Malachi like he knew he was lying. Really? Yeah, why is that a problem? Malachi knew he was being defensive, but he couldn't help himself. Ben relaxed. Oh, man, it's not a problem. Come on in. Me and Zaire were just catching the highlights and having a couple drinks. Malachi walked in and greeted Zaire, who was sitting on the couch. What's up, man? Long time no see. Zaire smirked. What's up? Malachi said as he plopped down on Ben's armchair. The trio watched the highlights for a few. While Ben and Zaire cracked jokes, then as soon as it went to commercial, things got real. A breaking news notification displayed across the screen and a reporter popped onto the camera talking about a murder which was just committed in their city. Police are saying that the woman's body was found near the door of her apartment. A neighbor happened to be walking by and saw her front door open. Malachi felt his entire body growing hot as the story unfolded. His dumb ass should have closed the door. Stupid! Anyway, his eyes shot to Ben and Zaire. Ben appeared to be studying him. You good, man? Malachi swallowed. No, not really. What's up? Zaire asked, looking intrigued. Malachi's eyes went from the screen to his friends and back to the screen. I think I made a mistake. And that's the end of that chapter. This, I told you, listen, look up dumbass criminals, not stupid criminals, not dumbest criminals, dumbass criminals. Malachi, right there. Same sucker on the book, right? Looking stupid. Hey, Jewel Cray, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Irk and Jerk, hey, girl, hey, thank you for being here as well. All right, let me make sure I didn't miss nobody else. Hey, Tiffany. Hey, girl. Hey. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. All right, here we go. Getting this next time stamp. All right, so I got it now. Y'all just got to wait about 5 seconds. Chapter 27. Malachi didn't know if this was the dumbest thing he'd ever done or if it would help him, but he spilled the beans. Oh, my God. And y'all, I really think Ben is the one that is the fucking, you dig, the, what is it, the Avenger. I really do think that the Avenger is Ben. I don't think it's Shartasia, or it might even be somebody from his work. I don't know. Like, it's going to be somebody that we don't even think. Like, maybe even, it might even be, what's her name? Zoe might be her mama or daddy. You know what I'm saying? But it's going to be somebody that we wouldn't even suspect. That's what I think. You know? I don't know. Damn. Okay, let me shut up. All right. Where was I at? He laid out the entire story from the beginning for Ben and Zaire, telling them about all the Avenger had done and how he was almost entirely sure that it was Shartasia. I don't know why he's saying that. That's kind of pissing me off because I don't think that she the one. I really don't. Like, how? What would that benefit her? Hey, Shakara, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. You think the Avenger is Zoe Jewel? Man, I don't know. I don't know, y'all. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know how. Okay, so let me see. If it wasn't her, why would she have just driven by your house? Malachi finished, staring at Ben. Ben's arms were crossed while Zaire's forearms rested on his knees during Malachi's account. Are you sure it was her car? Ben asked. Malachi nodded. I'm pretty sure. Damn. Well, if you really think she's involved, I think you should go to the police and tell them. I can understand if she was upset about you playing her, but that's no reason to go and kill someone who was innocent. Malachi felt like scum with the way Ben's statement came across. He already knew he was the reason Leia was killed, but to have someone else say it only made it worse. Wait, Wait a second, Zaire was saying. I don't think you should go to the police. What if they think you're just trying to accuse Charte? You're to take the heat off yourself. You just said you deleted all the messages off her phone. That's suspicious as fuck, Malachi. Then cut in, yeah, but if he goes forward, they'll likely believe he was just afraid. Excuse me, and when did you graduate from the police academy? Nigga, think! He shows up to her house and just so happens to find her dead. Then he wipes up the whole scene and tries to get rid of the evidence? Ain't no way he's getting out of there without being arrested. They'll hang his ass out to dry before he finishes signing his statement. Malachi listened to both of his friends as they bickered back and forth. It almost made him wish he'd never mentioned what happened. He could see validity in both of their positions, and that only made things worse. He was damned if he did and damned if he didn't. If Chartasia had done this, who was to say she hadn't taken pictures of him at the scene just to show to the police to make him look guilty? This could all be a setup. Malachi shook his head. He was going to have to sleep on it before he made a decision. If he could sleep at all after the day's events. And there's another break in the chapter. Wait a minute. So Demo said, I think it's Zoe too. She's never around and always gone because the bitch is working all the time. She like Michael Jackson, working day and night. Right. And when she ain't working, she's sleeping. When does she have time to do it? I don't understand. I don't know. Listen, stranger things have happened. I don't know. Stranger things have happened. So let's see. Hold on, y'all. Hey, Cupcake. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I think... that might be better. Okay. Thankfully, Zoe was working a double, so Malachi had a few hours to himself when he got back home. He shot her a text saying that his convention was canceled and gave her a bogus explanation about him not realizing it till the last minute because of the email being sent to a spam folder. She wrote back saying she was happy he wasn't leaving. I was only going to be worried about you anyway. Plus, I have some news. She sent a heart emoji along with her message. Malachi felt sick to his stomach, conflicted about what news she possibly had for him. It was as if the Avenger could read his thoughts because Malachi walked up to the door of him and Zoe's apartment to see a plastic bag fastened to the knob. He rolled his eyes, then froze. There was something sticking out of the bag, something that looked familiar. He hurried over to see that it was the dish towel from Leia's apartment, along with a note. Now that we have an understanding, it's about time you had a conversation with your woman. You don't have long before I make my next move. Uh-oh. Y'all, who the fuck, whoever this is, yo, they got access, okay? Not just a little bit, but a lot. Like, oh my God. I don't know. I'm trying to think, like, who could possibly maybe it's Banks. What if it's Banks, y'all? I don't know. Girl, I ain't even wrote the next damn timestamp down. I'm sitting up here rubbing my chin like a fucking private investigator. Oh my God. I'm like, okay, shit, bitch, you gotta read. You think it's her dad, D. Reed? I'm saying that, right? I'm saying, I promise you, I think. His dad dead. His dad is dead, Shakar. Remember he died in the hospital? Hey, Dior, welcome. I do. I do, too. I really do. I think it's her dad because he feels like, you know, hey, I don't want you to hurt my daughter. But he got a lot of fucking nerve because he cheated on her fucking mama, which is why I said I think it's the mama. What if it's her mama? Or what if it's Banks trying to say, hey, I'm going to get your ass back, you know, because you fuck my bitch. So I don't know. I don't know, y'all. Fuck. Did we go past the damn thing? Motherfucker. All right, let me stop talking, y'all. But yeah, I don't know who... I do. I don't know. We just gonna wait and see. I'ma just fucking read. What if he faked? No, he died in the hospital. They put him in the ground at the funeral, girl. Remember? He gonna fake it. No, God. All right. Chapter 28. There was no way Malachi could sleep after what happened. Images of Leah plus thoughts of the dish towel kept pummeling his brain. He was really about to go down for a murder he didn't commit. He felt responsible for Leah's death by wrapping her up in his bullshit, but he wasn't the one who pulled the trigger. The Avenger did. And now they were about to frame him. Didn't he deserve it, though? Of course, Malachi had never committed a serious crime or intentionally set out to hurt anyone, but he imagined that he probably broke a lot of hearts when he was in his fuckboy stage after LaTanya, his high school sweetheart, cheated. He knew for a fact that he broke Chartage's heart as well as Aaron's, but he never knew their pain could run that deep. Malachi had a lot of thinking to do because now the Avenger was basically forcing him to tell Zoe what he'd been up to. He didn't know how he would ever live with himself if he broke her heart too. "Hey," Zoe said, all smiles as she entered their apartment. Malachi had just finished watching a late-night news segment of the unfolding story of Leia's murder. Then he switched to another channel as he heard the key turning in the lock. "Hey," Malachi said, trying to force a straight face. It didn't work. Zoe immediately looked concerned. "What's wrong?" Malachi turned and faced the TV screen. He could barely look at his woman anymore. "Nothing, just thinking about my father." Pause. LaTanya, what if it's the old bitch from back in the day? Like, nigga, you fucked me up and now I finally found you and I'm gonna ruin your life. You know, what if she's on that shit? So D-Mo said, "I think Zoe know he's cheating and want him to come clean of it all." Child, I don't know. I don't know, y'all. I feel some type of way, Lord Jesus. I don't even, you said that, wifey, yesterday? I ain't see that. I don't know, but anyway, okay. Zoe was silent for a moment. "Malachi, I think I'm going to take some time off work. Maybe you and I should get away somewhere. I can see that Marcus's death is eating you up inside. I've been so insensitive. I'm sorry, baby." Her voice cracked. Malachi was up out of his seat before she could finish her sentence. Guilt coursed through his entire body. To think that the real reason he was even home tonight, much less sitting on the couch looking pitiful, was because of the fact that he was headed on a trip to Jamaica with another woman who ended up being murdered was too much for him. He would never forgive himself. He knew it. Here Zoe was trying to comfort him, bending over backwards for him in every way. And this was how he repaid her? By having the audacity to make her feel bad for being a good woman with goals and ambitions? Reality hit Malachi like a ton of bricks. He wasn't worthy of a woman like Zoe. He didn't deserve her. She deserved another man, a man like his friend Ben, someone who would love, nurture, and cherish her, not cheat on her behind her back while she worked hard to build a future. He was breaking things off tonight. There was no way he could allow the Avenger to do something to Zoe, not on his watch. "Baby, listen," he started, grabbing her in his arms and holding her close. His heart was pounding wildly. He was really about to break things off with his woman, but he couldn't find the words. Zoe looked up into his eyes. Malachi had to blink to lessen the effect of her sincerity having it on him. "What is it, Malachi?" She spoke in a small voice as if she was afraid of what he was about to say to her. "I have something to tell you," he said. Zoe looked down. "I had something to tell you too, but..." "What is it?" She shook her head. "I don't know if it's the right time." Damn. Malachi knew what it was. This night was getting worse and worse. It all started making sense now. Zoe's recent absent-mindedness and forgetfulness. The fact that she'd been emotional lately. How could he not see the signs? Oh, yeah. It was because he was too busy with all his extracurricular activities, just like his father. "Are you pregnant?" he blurted out before he could stop himself. Zoe finally looked back up with tears in her eyes, then nodded. "I just officially found out today. I know it's not the best time, though." No, Malachi was not about to let her feel guilty for what should have been a happy occasion between them, all because of his own selfishness. He would find a way to sort everything out later, but he was letting Zoe have this happy moment. "You're serious?" Malachi forced excitement into his tone and facial expression. Zoe looked like she was catching on. "Yes." Then she looked unsure. "But is this okay right now?" Malachi assuaged her fears. "Baby, it is more than okay. We need some good news with what we're going through. I'm over the moon. Hallelujah." He picked Zoe up and twirled her around for emphasis, though he feared that God was about to zap him with lightning right then and there for the show he was putting on. When he put her down, Malachi saw that the sparkle was back in Zoe's eyes. "I'm so happy that you're happy," she said. "We're having a baby." And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, let me tell y'all something. You see how this nigga playing this whole fucking game with her? Yeah. And been playing it for however many years they've been together. That's that long con.
Right.
Man, that is fucked up, yo. I don't even know. That was the end of that chapter. I'm annoyed. Hey, Akira, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Yeah, because men be having problems keeping their pings in their pants pockets, Amir. You know that already. You know that. Hey, little mama. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Let me try to... Okay, let me see. Okay. Now, let's see. I gotta flip my page over and start at the top here. Okay. Get my next time stamp, and we just gonna wait and let it count down while I sip some water. Yeah, I say that because they always trying to put it somewhere else, child. That's why. Chapter 29. Malachi went to Alice's house to do the exchange of Makai with Shartasia. The exchange. Malachi grew more disgusted with himself by the second, despite the fact that he hadn't taken his eyes off Shartasia as a suspect for being the Avenger. Was this really what he was about? Playing one woman who thought they had a future together while sleeping with his baby mama behind her back, along with his ex-girlfriend who was in a relationship with a drug dealer? All of that was bad enough without thinking of Leia, a woman who was innocent in this whole thing. She got caught up in some bullshit she never saw coming, all because of Malachi. Malachi was the common denominator in all of these situations. He couldn't effectively co-parent with Shartasia because he'd been sending her mixed signals by sleeping with her and making her think they had a chance of getting back together. He knew good and well she was holding out hope, but instead of being straight with her, he strung her along, knowing the whole time he was planning to marry Zoe. Granted, he did recently break off the sexual part of their relationship, and him playing her still didn't give her a right to kill Leia, but still, in the eyes of justice, it was his fault. And Aaron, it was also Malachi's fault she was in the predicament she was in now. If he hadn't jumped to conclusions all those years ago and slept with Shartasia at that party, he and Aaron would still be together now. But would you? His conscience asked him. Before he cheated on Aaron, he'd been following her around, trying to make sure she wasn't cheating on him. When he thought she was sleeping with the man who turned out to be her cousin, Malachi immediately jumped ship. Did Aaron's perceived actions really give him a right to seek revenge, or did they just uncover what was probably in his heart all along? Or was she bullshitting him, talking about that was her motherfucker cousin? Child, niggas be having phantom sisters and cousins and aunties and all that shit. Fuck out of here. Malachi didn't even want to think about Zoe. She was pregnant with his baby, and he had been planning to propose, but perhaps Xander and Zelda were right. He wasn't worthy of their daughter. Not because of the job he worked, but because of the type of man he was. He tried to deny it all his adult life, but he was just like his father, a liar and a cheater who cared for no one but himself. Malachi envisioned himself dying alone like Marcus did. Marcus squandered his life, chasing women and living in the wind. Look where it led him. Was that where Malachi wanted to go? It appeared so from his actions. But how could he change? What could he do to make all this right? Malachi, what's wrong with you? Alice asked as soon as she saw the perplexed expression in his features. Malachi shook his head. Just going through a lot right now, Ma. Did Shartasia text you? Alice shook her head. Not yet. I was trying to wait till you got here to give her a call, but she usually would have texted me by now. Malachi's mind went haywire. What was Shartasia pulling now? She always came on time with their son. Then he calmed himself down. Maybe she was just running late. Why hadn't she texted Alice, though? That was their routine. Alice was already on the phone calling her. Hello, she said when Shartasia answered. Yes, Malachi and I are waiting for you. What? Shartasia, are you serious? Now you know you... Okay, I'll talk to you later. Alice hung up looking pissed. What happened? Malachi asked. Alice turned to him. Shartasia is on her way to a prior engagement with Makai. She says she meant to tell us sooner, but it slipped her mind. A prior engagement? What prior engagement? Malachi was growing antsy, but he wasn't trying to let his anxiety overtake him. Alice shrugged. I have no idea, but I don't appreciate the fact that she didn't let us know ahead of time. How does she know I didn't have something planned? I swear, people can be so inconsiderate at times. Malachi tuned Alice's rant out as he tried to calm himself yet again. What the hell was really going on with Shartasia? Alice must have noticed Malachi wasn't listening because she cut off her own rant to ask him what was wrong. Nothing, Ma, he sighed. It's definitely not nothing, and don't lie and say you're thinking about Marcus either. I know you. It's something else. Caught again. Alice always knew when Malachi was up to something from childhood to this day. He decided to admit it. Zoe's pregnant. He braced himself for the onslaught, but it didn't come. Instead, Alice looked at him with such disappointment, he knew he'd never forget it. Wow, Malachi, she said. Wow. Malachi didn't need to ask her why she said that because he already knew. Alice had put the pieces together a long time ago, always getting on him about his lying and cheating ways. She'd always told him to stop playing with fire or he'd end up getting burned. He didn't listen, and now look where he was. Ma'am, your son is a bum. You should have been punching his ass in the fucking throat when he was 13 and you start telling his ass. Child, anyway, that was a break in the chapter. Hey, nice and thick. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Oh, my God. Just tell me who the fucking Avenger is. Oh, my God. Okay. I swear I'm trying not to, you know, I'm... Oh, my little buddy, the cat is outside. Anyway, Zoe texted Malachi as he was leaving Alice's house. Hey, can you pick me up from work tonight? Pick you up from work? Malachi wrinkled his nose. Sure, why? What happened? She shot back a reply. Car was acting up on the way there this morning. Then it shut down on the highway when I went out for my lunch break. Caught an Uber back to work and had it towed. Had it towed, Malachi's mind was swimming. This shit was getting out of hand. He knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Avenger was behind this. Zoe's car was all of a sudden acting up right after he received his latest threat. Bullshit. He was definitely picking his woman up from work. Maybe they should get out of town for a few days so Malachi could figure out a plan to move forward. Now, I thought that he was going to suggest that they take the Jamaica trip, remember, when she was over there telling him that she was pregnant. But, you know, he's so fucking dumb. Anyway, Malachi texted Zoe and asked her for the information on where her vehicle was towed to. When he called the company, they told him that the parts she needed were coming in a few days, so she would likely need a rental. Malachi knew Zoe wouldn't like that news since she was a stickler about saving every penny they could toward their new house. He would come out of pocket for her rental expenses. It was the least he could do. In the meantime, he contemplated his options for getting out of town for a few days. He wasn't sure if that was a good idea, though, with Leia's murder still looming over his head. It ain't looming over his head yet, but him thinking that it is gonna make it be. Damn. He don't know who she knows. Anyway, then a text came through from Zaire, which changed all that. And that's the end of that chapter. She could know a whole bunch of fucking dope boys and maybe somebody, you know, I mean, any type of scenario. I'm just saying, like, he acting like it's over. He said, ain't nobody came and talked to him. No cops, no nothing. But you constantly dwelling on it like a fucking idiot is gonna make it happen. Dumbass. Anyway, Child, we don't know. It might be this Latanya. It might be her. The Latanya chick. From back in the day. But yeah, we definitely think Ben, because he the one always acting funny. Chapter 30. You gotta be the luckiest nigga alive. Plus, who would have thought? Zaire had texted. He'd sent the message as a group text to Malachi and Ben, along with a screenshot of a news article. The headline said, "A woman's mysterious murder solved. Domestic violence at its worst." Malachi's heart sank to his stomach as he found the article online and read it. Ben and Zaire were blowing up the group text, but he wasn't reading their messages. He was reading the article, and it was making the hairs on the back of his neck stand at attention. Apparently, Malachi wasn't the only man Leah had been seeing. She'd recently broken up with her longtime boyfriend, Alexander Murray, a.k.a. Banks. Yeah. Boom. Boom. I ain't gonna drop my damn mic, but yeah. Mm-hmm. That part. That's what it is. See? Now he the dope boy. And already after what you call it. So yeah, he killed her because he found out that she was dipping and doing, tiptoeing through the fucking tulips and about to fly out to Jamaica. Jamaica, man. Uh-huh. Right. With old boy, Malachi, the same nigga who was just over there dipping and doing with his current bitch. How you gonna fuck my little yeah, or my ex yeah, and my current bitch? Nigga, who is you? Yeah, mm-hmm, now we got it. Okay, let me be quiet. Malachi continued reading the article, becoming more confused with each paragraph. From what the article was saying, Banks had been beating on Leah for years. Her friends and family tried to get her to leave him, and she finally did, but Banks wasn't ready to let her go. He sent threatening messages to her phone, then killed her. Wow. Wow. Oh my God. So the Avenger is still, man. This is, yeah. All right. An anonymous caller tipped off the police about Banks's involvement, and they pulled him over and found the murder weapon in the trunk of his car. Whoa. That was the part that confused Malachi. He'd been sure the Avenger killed Leah. How could Banks have done it? Was Banks the Avenger? If not, how could the Avenger get the murder weapon in his vehicle? Aaron. Malachi didn't know what to think. Was Aaron somehow involved in all of this? Did she know about Leah and Banks? They had to have been seeing each other at the same time Aaron was seeing Banks, because they'd been together for years. Was Aaron the anonymous caller? Was she the Avenger? If so, why? How? Malachi didn't know what to believe or who to trust. He had to find Aaron. He drove by her and Banks' apartment, but of course, she wasn't there. He stopped by her job and she wasn't there either, though now Malachi wasn't even sure she was working there anymore. Could Aaron really be the one behind all of this? That would break Malachi's heart more than any other person. Malachi loved Aaron. He'd messed up their relationship all those years ago by being paranoid, then jumping to conclusions, but his feelings for her never ceased. If she had done all this to him, though, did that mean she never loved him back? A tear crept to the corner of his eyes. It couldn't be. Aaron was clearly afraid of Banks. He'd seen it that day at Marcus's funeral, and he'd seen it that night, the last night they'd shared together, the night Banks came home and almost caught him. And Banks had given her a black eye and all but told Malachi he was beating on her. But how could Banks be the Avenger? Malachi didn't know the guy outside of his relationship with Aaron. Was Aaron the one who tipped the police off about Banks? The questions were endless and Malachi needed answers. He was going to find Aaron and learn the truth one way or another. He's stupid. Nigga, you need to be finding yourself and making some decisions, because the shit you about to go through is life-changing, you motherfucking pea-brained idiot. Jesus, this man is dumb. And you already got a child, Makai, and you ain't teaching him shit. His baby mama, a fucking ghetto ass bird that you done slept with once raw, and then she ended up getting pregnant. So damn stupid. Here we go. All right, let me get this other. Oh, Lord. I should have poured some of this thing into a separate cup. This big ass cauldron of coffee. But I like it. It's heavy. Chapter 31. All of Malachi's contemplations about Aaron and Banks halted when he got home. He walked in his apartment to see Zoe sitting on the couch, bawling her eyes out with 8x10 photos sprawled all over the couch and floor. Malachi dropped his car keys where he stood. He didn't know what to say. This couldn't be happening. Baby. How could you? Pure rage was etched across her features as she looked up at him from the photos. You fucking bastard! Malachi swallowed, his vision becoming blurred from his own eyes filling up. Zoe, fuck you, Malachi. I get a delivery of black roses at my job along with a crisp white envelope. I should have known it was going to be some bullshit when I read the outside. It said, when you think your man is faithful. Whoop. Wow. That's crazy. Sorry. Oh, but stupid me. Here I was thinking it couldn't be my Malachi. Oh, no. I got a good man. My man loves and supports me. But the whole time you were a fucking liar and a cheater. Malachi was speechless as Zoe continued. You pig! I asked you years ago if you still had feelings for Shartasia, and you lied to me. You told me that she was your baby mother and nothing more. You told me that Aaron chick was just a friend and your relationship with her was in the past and nothing serious. Yet these pictures show you fucking both of them. Malachi stepped forward, trying to find a way to explain. I broke things off with him. I swear, Zoe, I swear. Zoe leapt from the couch with a butcher knife in her hand. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. He hadn't even noticed she had it right next to her. Malachi held his hands up in protest. Whoa, baby, wait. No, fuck you. I supported you, nigga. I loved you. I bent over backwards working damn near 7 days a week for your ass. I did everything I could to build a future for us, and this is how you repay me? This is what you do? Zoe ran forward with the knife, and Malachi just missed her plunging it into him by jumping out of the way. Zoe, chill. He tried to grab at her arms, but she kept swinging the knife every time he did. Baby, calm down. No, I ain't fucking calming down. What was it, Malachi? Because from my angle, I did everything I could for you. I fucked you. I cooked for you. I supported your dreams. I defended you against my parents. What was it? Or were you just using me from the start? Malachi blinked. Using you? You needed a chick who was dumb and naive, someone who would sincerely believe you were down for her, one who would be so gullible that she respected you enough not to check through your phone and follow you around everywhere. I can't believe I was so stupid. Finally, Zoe dropped the knife, then wrapped her arms around herself. I can't believe I trusted you. I can't believe it. She kept shaking her head like the whole situation had blindsided her. Malachi felt lower than scum. He had done this. He caused Zoe this level of pain. She was losing it right in front of him, and there wasn't a thing he could do to console her. She sniffled and wiped her tears. I'm getting the fuck out of this house, she said, and stormed toward the door, picking up Malachi's car keys on her way. Zoe, wait! She slammed the door behind her, and Malachi stood in the middle of the living room floor like a lost puppy. Now, that's the end of that chapter, but check it. If anybody trying to kill his ass and she driving around in his car, guess who fit to die? Him. Just like when Raven was driving Maison's car. That's how she ended up getting murked accidentally. Anyway, let me get the next timestamp. Oh my God, today. Okay. This is turning out better. Right, wifey, popcorn and shit, I'm mad. I am really mad. Wait a minute. Buck gonna say Zorro ready to put a Z across Buddy's chest. Your ass, silly. Call that damn lady Zorro. All right, chapter 32. All of this was too much. Malachi couldn't take any more. He called Zoe back to back before he realized she'd left her phone on the couch in her rage. He had no idea where she was going. He could only pray she would come back home soon. He tried to unlock her screen to see if he could contact her parents, but he couldn't remember her password. She'd given it to him in the past, but he couldn't remember it now when he needed it the most. He felt pathetic. He was pathetic. There was no coming back from this. Malachi didn't know what to do, so he called Ben and Zaire to come over. Damn, bro, you've been going through it, said Zaire when he and Ben arrived. Right, Ben agreed. As soon as you got rid of one issue, here comes another. Ben's phone buzzed with a call, but he rejected it. Zaire eyed him. Who was that? Ben shook his head. Nothing. He turned to Malachi. So, she finally found out, huh? Malachi tensed. Why you say it like that? Ben shrugged. I'm saying it like that because that's exactly what it was. You were fucking around on her for years, man. I told you countless times to chill, but you never listened. Now look where you are. Malachi curled his lip up. Man, fuck you. Oh, it's fuck me because I'm telling the truth? All I'm doing is being real, Malachi. It's niggas like you that make it hard for guys like me. Ben pointed to himself and to Malachi as he spoke. Zaire jumped in. Ben, now is not the time or place for that. You see he's all fucked up. Show the nigga some love. I am showing him love. Tough love. Yeah, but that's not the way you... Malachi held his hands up. Just stop it, both of you. I don't need y'all bickering back and forth like some females. I know I fucked up. Ben, you're right that she was gonna find out, but I tried to change, man. I told Shartaja I wasn't fucking with her no more. Ben cocked his head to the side. Yeah, and what about Aaron? Not too long ago, you were just running to her house because Zoe had to work late. And this is not to add salt to the wound, but are you really gonna sit here and convince us you wouldn't have fucked Leia on that trip? Malachi paused at the mention of Leia. He wished Ben hadn't gone there. He was trying to get over what happened to her. He had no response for Ben's words. Zaire cut in again. All right, let's stop talking about all this sad shit. Turn on the TV or something. We got to take his mind off Zoe, Dr. Phil. He said that last part with sarcasm, and Malachi could tell that Ben caught it, but he didn't say anything further. He just helped Malachi pick up all the photos and black roses Zoe had strewn across the room and threw them in the kitchen trash. When they were in the kitchen alone, Ben approached the subject again. I want Ben to go home and mind his goddamn business. Old stanky booty ass nigga. Like, mind your business. You said the shit already. What else is it left to talk about? He clearly is the owner, motherfucking captain, and doctor of Team Fuck Up. Okay? Like, what do you want the nigga to do? He can't undo it. All right. Look, Malachi, I wasn't trying to be hard on you in there. I'm just trying to look out. You shared with me before how you really cared for Zoe. I was just trying to make sure something like this didn't happen. Malachi nodded as he felt his friend's sincerity. He blinked back his emotions. I appreciate you. You did tell me, but I wasn't hearing it. I can only hope she'll give me another chance. The guys stayed until past midnight. Then they both headed home because of having to work in the morning. And it's another break in the chapter. Oh, y'all, this is some bullshit. Ugh. Malachi called out of his job when he woke up. He knew he wouldn't be able to function with his mind on Zoe. He went into the kitchen room. No, the kitchen room. Saki, what the fuck is the kitchen room, bitch? Kitchen ain't even there. Into the living room to turn on the TV, but a knock on the door interrupted his movements. Zoe? He asked, then went to open it. His heart dropped when he saw two police officers standing there. Malachi Waters, one of them said. Malachi's legs became weak. His tongue felt like sandpaper all of a sudden. Yes, it's me. Do you know a Zoe Rivers? Malachi swallowed. Yes, his heart was thumping out of control. May we come in for a moment? The other officer asked. Malachi couldn't say a word, so he just let the officers in and closed the door behind them. He tried to brace himself for whatever was about to come out of their mouths, but nothing could prepare him for what they had to say. The first officer, Officer Thomas, spoke up. Malachi, we have some news. Perhaps you should sit down. He gestured toward the couch, but Malachi refused to budge. He crossed his arms over his chest and began rocking back and forth. No, I'm good. What news? Officer Thomas nodded at Officer Reynolds. She spoke next. Sir, there apparently was an accident sometime between last night and this morning involving a vehicle which was registered in your name. We found identification at the scene. Malachi's mind was swimming. He was fighting to maintain focus as the officers proceeded to tell him that Zoe was gone. His breathing became labored as he heard the words explosion and fire, and his ears picked up the explanation that Zoe was burned beyond recognition. His car had flipped several times after going over a guardrail on a rocky hill. They weren't sure what caused the explosion. The only thing they knew was that a woman was inside the vehicle, and the woman was Zoe based on her driver's license and dental records. We ask you to identify her body, but the way her body... Officer Reynolds stopped when she noticed that Malachi was losing it. Officer Thomas showed a photo from his cell phone. Do you recognize this necklace? We recovered it from the body. It was badly burned, just as Malachi imagined Zoe was, but Malachi did remember that necklace anywhere. He'd purchased it for her on their first year anniversary. Zoe wore it every day. This was all too much. Malachi took a step to move toward the couch and sit down, as the officers originally suggested, but he suddenly felt dizzy, then collapsed to the floor. And that's the end of that chapter. Ciao. Now this nigga's a bitch. So he just falling to the ground, breaking on down to the ground, right? All of a fucking sudden, I guessed. Hey, chocolate butterfly, welcome. Oops, there we go. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. I think I need to clean the eyeball on my mouse. Hold on, y'all. There we go. Let me see. Okay. Now, I got it all cleaned off. I guess that was the reason why I wasn't letting me click shit. Hey, Nora. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. All right. So I got Chocolate Butterfly and Nora. Yeah, no, she didn't deserve to go like that. But, you know, this nigga couldn't keep his peen in his pocket, so, you know, everybody around him suffers because he a bitch ass nigga. You feel me? That's just how that works. Hold on, y'all. I just feel like, I know you lying. These people be, oh my. Oh my God. I don't even know where Wilmer, Texas is. I don't know where that is. Where the fuck is Wilmer, Texas at? Bruh. Okay, I'm sorry, y'all. I don't think I can get nobody. I don't know. I don't even know where Wilmer is. All right. I might have to end this, y'all. There is apparently a woman in Wilmer that needs some help. I don't know. All right. Okay, so I just, whatever. We'll figure it out. Let me redo this damn timestamp. Oh, Lord. Men. Trash. Can't stop putting their hands on women's. What is the problem? Lord. All right, y'all, it's counting down. Chapter 33. Officers Reynolds and Thomas were able to bring Malachi back to consciousness just before another knock sounded at his door. Officer Reynolds went to open it, and yet another officer stood on the other side. Well, this is awkward. She joked, but the expression on Officer Reynolds' face must have told her this wasn't a laughing matter because she straightened up really quick. Malachi Waters, she said, and Malachi didn't even want to answer. Once his identity was confirmed, she went on to inform him that his mother, Alice, was rushed to the hospital because of being pushed down the stairs in her home by an unknown assailant. Malachi felt like the wind was knocked out of him at that moment. He couldn't bear it if his mother was gone too. As if Officer Hardaway could sense his apprehension, she alleviated his fears. She's in stable condition, but the doctors are saying her right hip was broken. Other than a few other bumps and bruises, she's fine. She wasn't fine. Nothing was fine. Zoe was dead, and someone just tried to kill his mother. Officer Thomas asked a question. Malachi, do you have any idea who might have done this to your mother? Damn right I do, he said, before the officer could finish his sentence. It's Shartasia Williams, my son's mother. Before this day, Malachi would never have snitched on Shartasia about anything, but this had gone way too far. His mother, Zoe, she had crossed the damn line. Officer Hardaway was writing something in her notepad. Why would you believe your son's mother would do this? Would you mind coming to the station?
Oh, shit.
Once they get your ass to the station, next thing you know, clink, clink, them cute little off-brand, or what they call them, dupe Chanel bracelets. The kind that dig into your wrists and leave marks and shit, you know? And they restrict your movement. Yeah, those bracelets. Oh, Lord have mercy. Oh, here we go. Hours later, Malachi emerged from the police cruiser in exhaustion. Officer Hardaway and her partner gave him a ride home while Officers Reynolds and Thomas went to Zoe's parents' house to tell them what happened. Malachi had informed them that he and Zoe's parents weren't exactly on speaking terms, so they reluctantly agreed to deliver the news to keep the peace. Officer Hardaway looked like she felt bad for him. Keep your head up, she said before driving away. Malachi didn't know which way was up as he entered him and Zoe's apartment. His apartment now, since Zoe was gone. He got all the way inside before he remembered his mother was still at the hospital. He turned to drive there. Then he remembered. Malachi swiped down his face with his hand. It felt that at any moment he would break all the way down. This Avenger person had done their job and done it well. He was so sure all the way to the police station that it was Shartasia. And when they started asking questions for his statement, he was already. Halfway through his statement, however, he started having doubts. Then he started thinking, maybe that was what the Avenger wanted. They wanted him to doubt himself. They wanted him to lose his mind. They were slowly but surely taking everything away from him, everything he cared about, everything he loved. Suddenly, Shartasia didn't seem like a viable suspect anymore. Not that it mattered anyway. Malachi could pick up from their body language and facial expressions that Officer Hardaway and her partner weren't convinced that he was right about Shartasia. They probably wouldn't even question her. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, a mess. Hey, Kay, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Yes, red ball it on back. You ain't missed too much. All right, let me get this next timestamp. Y'all, I swear it don't feel like we've been up here no hour and 2 minutes. I swear it don't feel like it. But apparently, we've been up here that long. Hey, Naomi. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right. Oh, I should have plugged that other thing up, but now I ain't got time. Fuck. I hope I remember. All right. Chapter 34. Ben and Zaire were certainly Malachi's rocks as of late. One phone call and they were heading over to bring him to the hospital to see about his mother. Damn, Malachi, Zaire said when they entered the apartment. Should I start laying low? Seems like your ass is cursed or something. He stopped short when he saw the dark look in Malachi's eyes. Ben assessed his friend. What is it? Malachi shook his head. Zaire's joking demeanor ceased. What is it, man? Malachi could barely get the word out, but he knew he had to tell them. Zoe. Don't tell me that, Ben said, a tear in his eyes. The Avenger got to Zoe? Malachi didn't answer. He couldn't move. He couldn't breathe. He felt like his world was crashing in on him. He'd been fighting off his panic attacks since all this started happening, but this was the strongest one of all. Both Ben and Zaire had to hold him down and help him calm himself before he completely lost it. After about 10 minutes, he finally began to calm. His face was covered in snot and tears. Ben went to the bathroom to grab him a roll of tissue. Zaire stood by him, telling him he was going to get through it. Once Malachi was cleaned up, they went to the hospital to see Alice. She was in there ordering her nurse around. Oh, and can you get me another pillow, please? These beds are so uncomfortable. His mother was laying on her side and covered in bandages, but she was alive and well. Malachi felt a brief moment of gratefulness for that. Mom, who did this to you? I don't know, Malachi. I was home alone. I had just finished vacuuming the upstairs and was about to head downstairs to do the same. I set the vacuum down to rest a second, and that's when I was pushed. I never saw him coming. Him who? Malachi, Ben, and Zaire said in unison. Malachi went on his phone to see if there was a chance that Banks had posted bail or something. He couldn't find anything. He turned to Ben and Zaire. If Banks did this, I swear. As soon as he said those words, it made sense. Banks was the only one capable of committing actions like this. He was the only one Malachi knew who was an actual criminal. Yes, Shartasia was reckless and had run him down with her car years ago, but that was because she was angry. Banks, on the other hand, had no respect for anyone, judging from Malachi's few interactions with him. Plus, he had a history of beating on women, as the news article stated. Malachi felt so stupid for questioning Shartasia when Banks was right under his nose all along. Banks? Who's Banks? Alice asked, looking confused. Aaron's boyfriend. Malachi let out the words before he had time to think about it. Alice gave Malachi a sharp look. You mean to tell me? Her voice trailed off. Malachi swallowed. I'm sorry, Ma. I never meant for something like this to happen. Alice didn't let up from her stern look. I bet you didn't. Malachi went back and forth from work to the hospital to home for the next week. He tried to talk to Xander and Zelda three times by going to their house. The first two times, they refused to answer the door, though he saw their cars parked right outside. And the third time, they called the police on him. Officer Reynolds was the responding officer. Malachi, what are you doing here? I'm just trying to give them some of her things, he said, holding a bag of sentimental items from him and Zoe's apartment. Also wanted to talk to them about the arrangements. He couldn't bring himself to say the word funeral. Felt like deja vu because he just attended his father's funeral a short while ago. He'd been checking the papers and the internet for an obituary or announcement of arrangements, but could find nothing. Officer Reynolds took the bag. I'll make sure they get it, but you can't come back here, okay? Well, how am I supposed to? Officer Reynolds forced a smile. I understand. Trust me, I do, but her parents don't necessarily see you in a positive light, as I'm sure you already knew. So they're blaming me? Officer Reynolds didn't answer. Malachi backed off. He stared at their house, then back at Officer Reynolds. He felt his heart hardening towards Xander and Zelda. He knew they didn't see eye to eye, but would they really believe it was his fault their daughter died? Fuck them then. Thank you for your help, he said to Officer Reynolds, then stalked over to his rental vehicle and drove off. And it's a break in the chapter. That's cold-blooded, though. I mean, I get it. Because they didn't like his ass. You know what I'm saying? So, like, at that point, it's kind of like, nigga, they didn't like you when she was alive. Alice was set to be released in the morning, and Malachi had taken that day off of work. He planned to stay with his mother and help her with all of her needs. She would also be having a home health aide work with her around the clock. Malachi didn't want to let her out of his sight. The Avenger was still out there, and Malachi wasn't taking any more chances. He was finally starting to doze off when he heard a knock at his front door. At first, he felt anxious, wondering whether this would be his end. For all he knew, the Avenger was standing outside his door ready to off him once and for all. He shook those thoughts from his mind and went to answer it. His jaw dropped in surprise. Aaron? Her eyes were full of tears. Malachi, I heard about Zoe. I'm so sorry. Huh. You know, who the fuck had said Aaron up top up there? Because this is kind of odd. Why is she popping up? Girl, you willing to risk it just to say, hey, I'm sorry your bitch died? Hell, mail him a note, bitch. Send him a text. What if Banks finds you and cut your damn throat? I don't understand that, but anyway. She trying to die. So that was the end of that chapter. Hold on, maybe I need to scooch over. And because the microphone is making some shit happen. Maybe like this. I don't know. We're going to see if that works. Chapter 35. Aaron stayed with Malachi for a few hours. She massaged his neck, back, and shoulders to help ease his tension and to help him get his mind off of all the recent happenings. Well, ain't that nice of her? She stayed there and gave him a massage. And then she gonna go home and get beat the fuck up. Malachi found himself telling her everything. Whenever he mentioned Banks's name, she would flinch, but she offered nothing further. Aaron, do you know if he posted bail after killing Leia? Malachi hadn't wanted to ask her that question outright because he had his suspicions about what Banks had been doing to Aaron, but he needed to know. She stiffened at his words, then turned away. I'm going to the kitchen to make us something to eat. Malachi wanted to press it, but decided not to. He was just happy to be in her presence again, despite everything that happened. It had been so long since he felt her touch, heard her voice. Aaron did things to him that no woman ever did, including Zoe. Leia was alluring. Chartasia was cool. Zoe was loving, dependable, and supportive. But Aaron had it all. She had everything, and Malachi had blown it. He wished more than ever that he could turn back the hands of time. She returned from the kitchen with some leftovers and chamomile tea. Here, she said, eat and drink. You look famished. Malachi stared at her. To tell you the truth, I don't even be hungry anymore. Aaron looked like his words pained her, but she could relate. Me either. Malachi opened his mouth to ask her something else, but decided against it. He didn't want to push her or scare her away. He'd been looking for Aaron for so long, ever since he'd found out what Banks was doing to her. He'd made efforts to help her get out of her predicament, but it wasn't nearly enough. He'd let her down all those years ago and then let her down again. Who knew what kind of torment she'd endured with that man? Malachi ate his food and drank his tea. It did the trick. Within the hour, he was nodding off to sleep. The last thing he remembered was Aaron covering him with a blanket. Then he was down for the count. Yeah, Banks is locked up. It's a break in the chapter. Banks is locked up, but he could have posted bail. I mean, well, we don't know if they gave him bail or nothing. The nigga ain't turned on the TV, so we don't know shit. Yeah, we don't know. He might have posted bail, hell. But I see the Avenger ain't doing shit right now. You would think something else would happen. All right. When he woke in the morning, of course, Aaron was gone. No note or anything. He went to the hospital to get Alice and bring her home. Her home health aide was supposed to be meeting them there. Malachi wanted to help her get settled in and spend the day together. Alice, however, wasn't down with his plan. She allowed her son to bring her home, but when he tried to go inside the house with her, she turned him down. Sorry, son, I just need a few days to myself. Malachi swallowed. Ma, what do you mean a few days to yourself? Alice looked like she was trying to be careful with her words. I can't be around you right now. Damn. Those words hit Malachi harder than he ever thought they would. His mother was rejecting him. Alice must have noticed the effect she had on him because she immediately tried to reassure him. It's just for a few days, Malachi. Let me gather my bearings. I'll call you. Her reassurance helped a little, but Malachi still felt like shit. Even his own mother was afraid to be near him, and it was all his fault. He'd caused all of this. He'd gotten himself into a hole and wasn't sure how he'd ever get out. With nothing else to do, Malachi headed home. When he got there, he saw an envelope taped to his door. I'm so sick of the envelopes and fucking pictures and dead flowers and fucking post-it notes and blood and dead squirrels in the mailbox. He shook his head, already knowing who it was from. Can't say I've never done anything for you, it read on the outside. This nightmare was never gonna end. Malachi took a deep breath, then opened the envelope. It contained Zoe's obituary and the time, date, and location of her arrangements. Malachi didn't have time to process what he was seeing. He had less than an hour to get there. He rushed and put together an outfit to make himself presentable, then headed to the church where Zoe's services were being held. He couldn't believe Xander and Zelda were really about to hold her whole funeral and not even allow him to pay his respects. They probably gonna stop his ass from even attending. Because they don't like his ass. Hey, Army vet, welcome. Thank you for stopping through. I appreciate you. When he got there, he had less than 5 minutes to spare before the service was set to begin. He rushed up to the doors, but was stopped by two armed guards who were standing outside. Please, I need to get in. I need to. Malachi Waters, you need to leave, one of the guards said. How do you? The guard cut him off, his expression cold and distant. We know who you are. Xander and Zelda Rivers gave us strict orders not to let you anywhere near the service. Why would they do that? Malachi felt himself growing frantic. The other guard spoke next. They said to give you this if you tried to show up. It was a large white envelope. Malachi was sick of envelopes by this point. They never seemed to contain good news. He opened it and saw two pictures, one of him and Shartasia in a compromising position, and the other with him and Aaron. Both were time-stamped. There was a note from Xander in the envelope as well. Come anywhere near my daughter's funeral and I will have you murdered. Try me. There was nothing he could do unless he wanted to die. Malachi parked a block away and waited until he thought the service might be over. Thankfully, he was right. He saw the procession of vehicles exiting the church, and he followed them to the gravesite. He at least needed to be there for that part. Her parents didn't want him there, but he owed it to Zoe. He hid behind some trees and watched the burial service. Xander and Zelda stood with stony expressions as the pastor officiated the service. Malachi recognized a few of Zoe's friends from her job and other people who looked like they belonged to the family. When the crowd dissipated, Malachi crept over to say his last words. He found himself overwhelmed with emotion. I'm sorry, baby. This is all my fault. He laid a single rose on top of her casket, but a white gloved hand snatched it away. Oh, yo, damn. Malachi whipped his head around to see Xander standing there with the rose in one hand and a gleaming silver handgun in the other. Malachi put his hands up. Look, man, I was just trying to pay my respects. Xander eyed him with contempt. Didn't I tell you to stay the hell away from my daughter's funeral? You already killed her. What more do you want? I would never kill her. She rushed out of the house. We had an argument. She committed suicide because of you, Xander spat. Malachi couldn't believe his ears. Suicide? Zoe didn't. He felt numb. We saw the photos, you asshole. Zoe received those same photos, and that's what pushed her over the edge. We knew you were no good for her. We knew she wouldn't be able to take it if you turned out to be exactly what we thought you were. What are you saying? Malachi could barely keep up with what Xander was telling him. Zoe often pushed herself too hard. She did everything she could to be perfect, never thinking she was good enough. I know she bent over backwards for your trifling ass, then you pushed her over the edge. No, you pushed her over the edge, Malachi thundered, finally finding his voice. You had just as much fault as I did, if not more. Yes, I cheated and I was wrong. But where do you think her issues developed? Zoe told me stories of how you and her mom treated her while she was growing up. Her problem started with y'all. Xander cocked his gun and pointed it at Malachi's head. Do it then, Malachi urged him. I'm ready. Just then, Zelda came running up. Xander, what are you doing? Let him go. This is all too much. Her face was stained with tears. Xander looked like he was trying to hold it together. He killed our daughter, he said, as if he was trying to convince himself rather than Zelda. Zelda was silent for a moment. Give me the gun, Xander. Xander stood there for a few moments with his gun still trained on Malachi. Then he finally let it down. Zelda took it from him, then turned to Malachi. Please leave. Malachi obeyed. I bet the fuck he did. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. A whole ass mess. Hey, Destiny. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I don't even understand. Like, I think at this point, who's left to die? Shartasia and Makai? The mama done already got shoved down the stairs, but she bounced back like Tupac, because, you know, five shots couldn't take him out. So, I mean, you know, they thought, I guess what, she was going to break her fucking neck? I don't know. But anyway, I got... this is crazy. Just got to let it count down. Y'all got about, I don't know, 15 seconds, something. Oh, Lord. Okay. Chapter 36. Malachi decided to cut his losses and move on. He'd learned his lesson, albeit the hard way, as Alice had warned him time and time again. Finally got it now. He was going to be on the straight and narrow moving forward because he wasn't cut out for the type of consequences he was facing. After a few days, Alice finally let him come back over to her house so they could see each other. It was only going to be for a brief moment because Malachi was picking up Makai for the weekend. Shartasia came to drop him off, but there was something different about her. It was her hair. She changed it from her usual style and cut it shorter. She'd also switched up her makeup style. Malachi had to admit she was looking good, but he wasn't going to kindle anything with her. She didn't appear to be interested in his conversation anyway. Shartasia barely said two words before she was driving off in her car. "Daddy, can we play football?" Makai asked. Malachi looked down into his son's excited eyes and resolved in that moment that he was going to do better. He was going to be better. No more women. Not for a while. He was going to focus solely on his son and his job and figure out his life. This is for what, like the fourth time? And then, as always, right after I fuck this next bitch, I'm going to get it together. Anyway, maybe after a few years, he'd be ready for another relationship. But for now, he was taking it slow. Unless Aaron come over there and sit that pussy on him, then he going to be right back in it with her. He deactivated all of his dating and social media profiles to prove to himself that he was turning over a new leaf. He also deleted all female numbers from his phone that he had saved under various aliases. He hadn't been in contact with any of these women for years, but he didn't want their reminders. He was a new man. He thought about it even further and decided to change his number. He went and bought a whole new phone to go along with it. It was a small shift, but a shift nonetheless. Malachi already liked the new man he was becoming. He spent the weekend with his son, and by the time Shartasia came to pick him up on Sunday, Malachi didn't want to let him go. For the first time, Malachi felt like he had truly broken new ground with his son. Makai was just like him in so many ways. He was like Shartasia too, but Malachi beamed with pride when he noticed the similarities between himself and Makai. The little guy was all right. He could tell Makai didn't want to leave either when their time was up. It was as if his son noticed a change in his father as well. Malachi would never forget that feeling or the look in Makai's eyes. It was a look of longing. Malachi recognized it well. He'd worn the same look for many years before he finally accepted the fact that his father just didn't have it in him. Malachi would not go out the same way. The decision had been made. He was already planning their next weekend and contemplating asking Shartasia if he could have him more days. Makai was a handful, so he was sure she wouldn't mind. And it's a break in the chapter. Like, this is, like, I'm trying to, like, what in the hell, you know? Okay. Thursday night, Malachi headed to Zaire's house to play poker with him and Ben. The guys had a great time, but Malachi got a little too wasted because of being so happy about turning over a new leaf in life. He and Ben decided to spend the night. Ben also finally revealed that the reason he'd been a little secretive lately was because he'd started seeing Jasmine from Malachi's mother's church and didn't want to jinx it. Child, listen, hold on. Okay. I must be allergic to these flowers, child. Some lady was being nice on the day of the eclipse, and she was handing out, you know, like batches of, I don't know where she bought them from, but they was all, you know, wrapped in paper, roses and lilies and whatever the fuck this other weird shit is in there. But anyway, y'all, I promise you, I've been sneezing since that shit been in here. Because I, you know, I brought it back to the house and shit and, you know, put it in a little vase and shit and put the little fucking aspirin that they had, whatever the fuck it is. I'm assuming it's aspirin. That's the fuck it looked like. So I put it in there. But, yeah, that, I've been fucking sneezing like crazy. I think I, like, you know, it's one thing because, like, y'all know I'm usually complaining about my nose being dry. But, listen. I've been sneezing all damn day. Now, not when I go upstairs, right, to get in the bed. None of, I don't, no sneezing up there because the shit is down here. But I tell you, when I come down the stairs and come around that corner. Child, listen. Ugh. It's annoying. And I'm about ready to punch somebody in the throat. But anyway, let me shut the fuck up about that. I think this might be it, Ben said with a twinkle in his eyes. Malachi was happy for his friend. One day he wanted the same for himself, but for right now, he was sticking to his commitment to his son, getting his mind right and working. His priorities were completely realigned. Truth be told, however, Malachi still thought of Aaron every night. She'd shown up out of the blue right before Zoe's funeral, but he hadn't seen or heard from her since. Now that he thought of it, that was kind of weird. No, he said to himself, shaking his head. He wasn't allowing his mind to go there. The Avenger hadn't said or done anything new, so he figured he was free. Malachi decided to relish in that freedom and just let everything go. He needed to move on. The next morning, Ben and Malachi said their goodbyes to Zaire before they went outside to head home themselves. Both of them had to work, so they needed to hurry. Malachi's heart dropped when he stepped outside Zaire's door to see that Ben's car was there, but his rental car was gone. Fuck! He said, pissed at the possibilities. What the hell happened to your whip? Ben said, as if Malachi knew. Irritated, Malachi was already phoning the rental company. Yes, I need to report a theft, he said, his heart sinking even further as he spoke. He already knew who was behind this. He gave them his information, but he was shocked to hear the ref's next words. Sir, you turned the car in last night. Malachi blinked. Come again? The rep sounded like he was getting impatient now that he realized the vehicle wasn't stolen. The vehicle was parked in one of our overnight drop-off spaces. The keys were left in the driver's seat along with a note thanking us for the rental. Malachi gritted his teeth. That motherfucker. I'm sorry, said the rep, thinking Malachi was about to curse at him. Sorry, I hadn't realized it was turned in. Was there any damage? Nope. And the gas tank was filled, so you are all set. Would you like to set up another rental since you apparently didn't realize this one was turned in? The rep was back to his nasty attitude, and Malachi didn't feel like dealing with it. He turned to Ben. Yo, can you drop me at work? Ben nodded. I'll call back later, he said to the rep and hung up. Ben didn't have to be into work until after Malachi, so he agreed to bring him home so he could get changed and drop him off at work, then head to work himself. When they pulled up to Malachi's apartment, he and Ben got out of the vehicle and started toward the door. Then Malachi noticed something strange. There was something sticking out of his mailbox at the end of the driveway. Fuck, not this shit again, he said. He handed his key to Ben. Go ahead inside and I'll be in. Ben took the keys and Malachi headed toward the mailbox. Malachi pulled the front license plate to his totaled vehicle from the mailbox just as he heard a thump and a moan coming from the front of the house. There was a sticky note on the license plate, which was partially charred. Think you're done paying yet? Malachi whipped toward the front door. It was already too late. Ben was laying inside his house and he wasn't moving. Malachi rushed over and saw blood pooling around Ben's head and 100-pound dead weight laying next to him. Ben moaned. Malachi's eyes filled with tears as he put two and two together. That dead weight was meant for him. A fucking booby trap. Ben, shh, don't move. I'm calling an ambulance. Malachi got on the phone as he watched his best friend's eyes rolling back. Come on, man. Stay with me. Stay with me, Ben. Ben couldn't die. He didn't deserve it. He'd done nothing wrong. Malachi felt useless and worthless as the next few minutes unfolded. The ambulance came and rushed Ben to the hospital. Malachi followed behind them and even called Zaire, who was on the way to work himself, to tell him what happened, but he didn't remember doing any of it. He was out of it. When was the Avenger gonna stop? They'd already taken everything from him. What more did they want? I don't know. You gotta ask Tyrese. He the only one that know the answer to that question. Because I know they answered his ass with the way he was crying like a really hurt person. A really, really hurt person. Oh my God. I don't want to call him that. Yes, Shakara. Now we can eliminate him. Eliminate, not eliminate. Eliminate. Yes, he has been eliminated. All right, that's it. Let me get the next time stamp, child, because in case I didn't say it, that was the end of that chapter. Listen, that goddamn Malachi ain't gonna be able to have nobody around him. What if that had been his shorty walking through the door? Dude would have got El Kabong like a motherfucker.
I'm going to learn to read. Oh, my God. Listen, I'm going to hell for that one. That is fucking crazy. All right, let me get All right, I got it. I got my time stamp. Y'all just got to wait and let it count on down, child. Huh, Lord. Girl, they keep pushing back the time. They're going to drop. If y'all could only know two little bitty ass little, what's the names that they supposed to become? They done put this shit from 3 o'clock to goddamn, I don't know what damn time. Just go to hell all day, every day. Oh, buttholes. Damn. Anyway, that's that. So we just waiting for the rest of the countdown. Yeah, we don't know Malachi, and we still don't like his ass. There we go. Chapter 37. Malachi and Zaire were frantic about Ben. This was getting to be too much. The police arrived at the scene. Two new officers and Malachi hounded them, telling them that Banks had done this and that they needed to arrest him. The officers were polite, but Malachi could tell they thought he was crazy. Sorry. I was trying to hold back a sneeze before. Oh my God. Lord have mercy. Okay. That is terrible. But I couldn't even speak to tell y'all that I had to sneeze, right? Shut up, wifey. Okay. And buck your ass going to hell. All right. We'll look into it, one of them said. I don't need you to look into it. I need you to arrest him, Malachi said. Zaire tried to calm him down. Malachi, chill. He looked as if he was shaken up by what happened. We need to focus on Ben right now. Malachi listened to his friend. They answered questions from the officers, then called Ben's parents to let them know what happened. His mother rushed over, and his stepfather came shortly after. Ben's brain was swelling, so he was rushed to the He was rushed to emergency surgery. Malachi and Zaire were on edge, hoping and praying right along with Ben's family that he would pull through this. Malachi felt like he had nothing left. Ben was his oldest friend. He couldn't go out like this. Finally, the doctors emerged with good news. We were able to stop the swelling, but he slipped into a coma. At this point, it's still give and take. No, not give and take. It should be touch and go, dumbass. What the fuck is give and take? Who giving and who taking? Idiot. If he makes it through the night, his chances for survival will be higher, but we'll keep you updated. Well, do we need to go play patty cake with the nigga to make sure he make it through the night? Like, what do we have to do here? This is fucking stupid. I don't understand. Malachi prayed with all his might that Ben would pull through. Lord, please. Lord Jesus, please. Zaire was in tears beside him. Yo, nigga, he whispered to Malachi so Ben's parents couldn't hear. I'm getting a gun. We're going to find that nigga Banks and end this shit tonight. Malachi was all ears. How we going to find him? Zaire paused. I don't know, but somebody got to know where he is. Malachi and Zaire were headed out of the hospital to go purchase a weapon and find Banks when they were stopped by Officer Reynolds, who was entering the hospital through the same doors they were exiting. Hey, Malachi, she said, then glanced at Zaire. What is it? Malachi was confused. What are you doing here? One of the responding officers for your friend, Ben, passed the case to me since you believed it was connected to what happened with your mother. I checked on Alexander Murray's case, and he's still in police custody. The judge didn't grant him bail at his hearing, so he's been locked up since the murder of his ex, Leia. I tried to call your phone to tell you this, but the line was disconnected. Malachi was at his wit's end. So you telling me there's no way Banks could be behind this? She shook her head. I'm sorry, no. We also checked on Chartasia, your son's mother, last week, and she had an alibi for the day your mother was assaulted. Malachi stared at her. She never told me y'all questioned her.
Officer Reynolds shrugged. Maybe she was upset at you. She was quite unruly when we brought her in. That didn't make sense. The Chartesia he knew would have blown a gasket at the thought of him trying to get her caught up. This wasn't adding up. What was going on? Thank you for the information, he finally said. Zaire stepped in. Wait a second, officer. How do you know Banks or Chartesia didn't pay someone else to do all this? Feels too coincidental to me. Officer Reynolds looked offended that he would suggest something like that, but Malachi thought it made sense. I'm sorry, who are you? Officer Reynolds asked. It was Zaire's turn to look pissed. My best friend is in there fighting for his life, and you can't put basic pieces of the puzzle together? It's clear there's some kind of connection going on here. Y'all ain't about to sit here and ignore that. Sir, I assure you, we're doing everything in our power. Y'all ain't doing shit, Zaire said, growing visibly heated. If it was a white man, the connections would have been made immediately. I feel like y'all aren't putting forth much effort because we're not one of you. Officer Reynolds' face reddened. Oh, she white. Okay, I thought she was black. I think I'm gonna leave. I've already discussed more of this case with you than I was supposed to. Forgive me for trying to help. Oh, shit. You done put Becky on the wrong side of your fucking case. With those words, she stopped off while Zaire was pacing back and forth, looking like he wanted to hit somebody. Come on, man, we'll find out who's behind this, Malachi said. Zaire gave him a cold look. Yeah, I hope we do, before it's too late. And there's another break in the chapter. Child, listen. What in the whole hell? Y'all just don't understand. This shit is crazy. I think I need to put this thing somewhere where there's no interference. Hold on, y'all. Okay. Maybe that'll be a little better. Visiting hours were finally over. The Avenger had been counting down. They straightened up their false doctor's uniform, clipboard in hand, and headed down the hall and around the corner toward Ben's room. Pity the job wasn't complete the first time around. The Avenger hated having to go back and do anything twice. They walked slowly down the hall, careful to look as natural as possible. They even smiled and waved at a few hospital employees for good measure, praying no one noticed that they looked unfamiliar. Feeling themselves growing impatient, they took a deep breath when they finally got to Ben's door. It was time to pull the plug. Pity, Ben was one of the good ones. The ones people like the Avenger didn't have to worry about. Ben wasn't part of the plan, but the Avenger wasn't going to let him lay there and suffer. They'd overheard doctors saying that he would likely be in a vegetative state for the rest of his life anyway. The Avenger was doing him a favor. They took another deep breath, then entered the room, stopping short as soon as one foot crossed the threshold. There was a woman in there crying. The fuck is she doing here? Who is she? The Avenger racked their brains trying to figure it out. They had kept careful notes and updates on Malachi and his friends and mother's whereabouts. They knew every move all of them made, but somehow this little bitch had slipped under their radar. Hello, young lady, the Avenger said in a cheerful voice, forcing a smile. Are you here for a visit? You know ours ended 30 minutes ago. The woman sniffled and wiped her tears. I know. They told me I didn't have long, but I didn't know he was in here. I had to see him. There she went, breaking down and crying again. The Avenger fought not to roll their eyes. There wasn't shit they could do now but pretend to comfort the woman since she'd fucked up the backup plan. No way they could pull the plug now without someone growing suspicious, even if they did get the woman to leave. It's gonna be okay, honey, they said, and gave the woman a hug. Little did she know, Jasmine, the Avenger, learned through subsequent conversation, had just saved precious Ben's life, or what was left of it. So Jasmine was the girl that was in there crying. And that's the end of that chapter. So now, Ben get to live as a fucking carrot in a vegetative state. So yeah, that's fucked up. Well, oh my God, I don't even understand, child. Listen, oh child,
I am tripping hard. Okay, let me see here. Child, y'all folks know y'all be on the replay, you heard me? Because listen, Linda. All right, hold on. Okay.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you, Sydney, for the tip. She said, for thank you for what you do. Oh, this is the cute little thing. I love listening to you while I work. Okay, I like all the colors. Okay. That's cute. Thank you, Sydney. Well, I'm glad I can help you get through your work day, darling. Okay. All right, let me get this time stamp, child, because now... First, my nose go dry, and now it's want to run because I'm sneezing and shit. A complete fucking mess. But that's all right. Let me ask y'all a question. Y'all just ponder it and put your answers. And anybody heard about supposed to be... Jay-Z and Beyonce getting a divorce or some shit. Y'all heard that? Somebody was saying that. Hey, Sydney, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Yeah, I was just thanking you. Didn't I welcome you already? I thought I did. And I got to be nosy for a second. But y'all tell me if y'all heard that. Let me see. I'm so nosy. I'm trying to see what, allegedly Buck said something that had y'all laughing and I wanted to know what it was because I'm nosy. They ready to have church lady usher him right out the back door. Got that part. She already gave him some chamomile tea and put him to sleep. Put who to sleep? Mama came back like Bushwick Bill. Mama tucked and rolled down the stairs, church lady. You going to hell. She said mama tucked and rolled down the stairs, yo. What the hell? Lord have mercy. Mm-mm. Okay, so I got it. I don't. I saw it. I'm so damn nosy. Okay, wait a minute. Tell me, it's not funny, but Ben getting done Tom and Jerry style got me weak, right? Because he damn sure got Ilka Bong. Hey, with Mo, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. yeah. Okay, so you said you ain't heard it. Jewel said, I did hear about that. She supposedly moved into another one of their homes. Hell, all she had to do was move to the other side of the motherfucker they live in. It's about 4 or 5 million square feet. So, shit. You know, I don't understand, but whatever, child. So Marva said, yes, said to be separated already. Well, child, I hate to hear about anybody's marriage coming to an end, but listen, Linda. Sometimes you got to do what you got to do. And Beyonce says, fuck that bullshit. Whatever you and that damn creep stain got y'all selves involved in, you ain't going to get me wrapped up, tied up, and sewed up in it. Mm-mm. Nope. So she says she didn't want no parts of it. No parts. And I don't blame her. Okay, there we go. Okay. Child, this thing is vibrating. Knock it off. All right, here we go. Sorry about that. Chapter 38. Malachi's eyes popped open at the sound of something scratching in his bedroom. He felt a draft of air. He glanced over at his bedroom window and saw the moonlight shining through. His window was wide open and his screen was slashed. He sat up in bed, an eerie feeling washing over him. He hadn't opened his window last night. He heard the scratching sound again, sounding like it was coming from his closet.
Something moved near his open closet door. He couldn't see what it was, but something was definitely moving in there. Now fully alert, he swung his legs over the side of the bed to get down. Whatever was in the closet was sitting still now. He grabbed his cell phone from his nightstand while internally freaking out. He went to the flashlight app, then shined it toward the open door. Red eyes peered back at him. Shit! He yelled out. Then the animal rushed toward him. It was a huge raccoon, and it was now wrapped around his left arm, biting the shit out of him. He shook to get it off, screaming at the wild animal, but it had a firm grip. His arm hurt like a motherfucker, and there was already blood pouring down his broken skin from the animal's teeth and claws. Fuck! He dropped his cell phone, then reached down and snatched up his blade from underneath his pillow, plunging it through the animal's midsection, finally stopping the attack. Some of the blood spatter got on his face. Malachi didn't have time to be disgusted. He just wanted to get the hell away from the thing. He stepped around the dead animal and flipped on his room light. The raccoon was laying on the ground and had wetness around its eyes and mouth. Aside from the blood that was now spreading in a small puddle on the hardwood floor, Malachi was sick to his stomach. Rabies, he said, then examined his arm. He was sporting some pretty deep cuts from where the animal's claws scratched him and a full mouth mark with broken skin where he was bitten. He didn't have time to think. He ripped off his shirt, wrapped his bloody arm in it, and picked up the keys to his newly acquired car from the nightstand to go to the emergency room. When he got there, thankfully, they were able to take him in quickly. The doctor gave him post-exposure prophylaxis, the rabies vaccine, and then told him that the medication should stop the virus, but he had to get 4 more shots over the next 14 days. "And you say the animal somehow broke into your house through the window?" the doctor asked him, clearly not believing that story. Malachi didn't even know why he told the man that. He must have still been out of it because of being half-asleep when he was suddenly awakened by the raccoon. This shit was getting spooky. Malachi only hoped it would be over soon.
Child, listen. Oh,
Malachi, why are you so fucking stupid? All right, it's a break in the chapter. That's why I stopped. A whole ass mess. Hey, Peanut. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Again, with your late ass. You're late. 30. Sounds like a nice number. All right. When he got back home, of course, the animal was gone. The blood was cleaned up. The screen was replaced. And his blade was gleaming and laying on top of his freshly made up bed. Malachi wanted to kick something. The Avenger was taking total control of his life, and he couldn't do shit about it because he had no idea who it was. There was no point in going to sleep after that, so Malachi stayed up for the rest of the night watching various shows on TV. I would be scared that I'm on camera somewhere with this motherfucker watching my every fucking move. Every time he dozed off, he swore he heard a sound in the house. Maybe I should move, he said to himself after waking up for the 5th time. And that's the end of that chapter. This nigga dumb. Girl, I don't know. But you know, they probably sell them at the 5 and dime, child. The 5 and dime. You can get one. They keep them in the back. You got to tell him you want to talk to Mr. Chang, and he'll get you one, hook you right on up. Let me see, get this damn timestamp. Okay, I got my timestamp, child. Yep, rabies. You know when you hang out with the people from Caucasia, they don't know how to let you go, right? Okay, that part. I got you. Caucasia, you silly. Chapter 39. Malachi called out of work in the morning so that he could look up other apartments. It was time to make a move. His boss, Julio, wasn't pleased. Malachi, you've been missing a lot of days lately. I understand you're going through a lot, but if you call out again, I'm gonna have to put you on a warning. Malachi paused. He didn't want to get into it with his boss on top of everything else that was already going on. Okay, man. I'll make sure to get back on track with my attendance. Great. You're an awesome employee, and we would hate to have to lose you. Malachi hung up the phone in frustration. He was in the middle of narrowing down prospective places when someone knocked on his door. He answered it, blade in hand, and to his surprise, it was Aaron. Why this bitch keep popping up like a bitch in a box? I don't understand. Go away. What are you doing here? He asked, suspicion rising within him. She gave him a strange look. I came to see you. Yeah, this the second time you've randomly showed up. What's going on, Aaron? What do you mean, what's going on, Malachi? Are you saying you don't want me here? He was tired of this bullshit. If she wanted to come in, she was going to have to answer some questions. Look, I'm going through a whole lot of shit right now, as I already told you. I need to know I can trust you before I let you in. Aaron looked like she was taken aback. Need to know if you can trust me. Malachi, what the hell are you talking about? I've never done anything to hurt you. Why won't you tell me what's going on with Banks then? Because I'm testifying against him. Aaron spat out the words and Malachi felt like shit yet again. Of course she was testifying against him. She was the last woman he was with, so the police were probably using her testimony against him for Leia's case. I'm sorry, he said when realization dawned. Aaron's eyes filled with tears. I can't believe you would suspect me of anything. I've never tried to harm you. I know, Aaron. I'm sorry. I swear. Malachi's voice trailed off as he ran his hand over his head. He felt like he was going crazy. The Avenger had done this to him. What happened to your arm? Aaron said, gesturing at his bandages. Malachi stepped aside to let her in. Come on, I'll tell you. She stepped inside and Malachi immediately felt a sense of comfort. He felt like there was someone on his side, someone who wouldn't judge him, someone who would understand. Malachi told her the latest about the Avenger and about his plans to move. I think that's the right idea. Why don't you come stay with me in the meantime? Shit, bitch, that ain't nowhere safe. Banks got people, and those people have guns. Matter of fact, I think it's time for you to bounce, bitch. Fuck is you doing here? Oh, God. This is crazy. Yes, you are with your peoples now. Yes, indeed. Thank you for that, child. Glad you made it back in one piece. It was Malachi's turn to be taken aback. Come stay with you. She nodded, then looked away. I mean, it's partially for selfish reasons. I don't want to be at that house alone. Banks's boys pop up on me from time to time just to scare me. I feel so trapped. See? What I just say? Hell no. Bitch, is you crazy? The nigga in jail. You think if they see me coming in and out this bitch, they won't tell him that and he won't get him the order to slice and dice us both like a log of Bologna? No. The fuck? All right. She put her head down. Malachi covered her hand with his uninjured arm. Aaron, he said, but he didn't know what else to say. He'd sat there complaining about his own problems when Aaron had a ton of her own. She was probably scared shitless of Banks, and now she had to face him in court to testify about the murder of another woman, a woman he likely cheated on her with and was abusing right along with her. She was probably afraid she would be next, regardless of whether he got off for Leia's murder. Malachi didn't know what to say, so he just wrapped his arms around her, and they stayed that way, comforting each other for a long time. And that's the end of that chapter, child. I'm like, what in the hell? Okay. This is a lot. A whole lot. Okay, I got the timestamp, so we ain't got that much further to go, y'all. It's only 48 minutes left in the book. So, yeah. All right. Girl, you done. Chapter 40. Malachi stayed with Aaron for the next few days as he spoke to various landlords and participated in viewings of different apartments. This nigga's dumb. He threw himself from the frying pan into the fire. The Avenger can find you anywhere. Anywhere. He's stupid. All right. He slept on her couch and didn't dare propose anything further between them. He knew he was already risking things with the Avenger lurking around the corner, being at Aaron's house, but he prayed for mercy just this once. He just wanted to move into this new apartment and put the past behind him. He didn't want any more trouble. He'd more than learned his lesson now. Malachi finally settled on an apartment, and moving day came before he knew it. He hadn't heard a peep from the Avenger, and Ben displayed movement in his hands that same morning. Ben's mom, Maria, had called to tell him the news. She, Jasmine, and Ben's stepdad, Abram, were over to the moon with excitement. Malachi and Zaire were going to head to the hospital to see him after they finished moving all of Malachi's things to his new apartment. Malachi had thrown away most of his possessions in his quest to start fresh. There weren't a ton of boxes to pack into the U-Haul, but he was grateful for Zaire's help nonetheless. Erin looked like she was sad to see him go, but he said he would cook her a dinner in appreciation for letting him stay with her as soon as he got settled. Zaire hopped in the U-Haul since he was going to be the driver, and Malachi headed into the house to get the last of the boxes. There were two left, but they were mid-sized, so he piled one on top of the other, then bent down to pick them both up at once. You know, Ben wasn't actually a part of the plan. Malachi dropped the boxes and whipped around to see Zaire standing at his front door with a gun in his hand and a deranged look on his face. Shock filled Malachi's features. The plan? Zaire, what the hell are you talking about? He looked from his best friend to the gun to his best friend again. He'd never felt so betrayed. Zaire chuckled. That dead weight was meant for you. He closed the front door behind him while keeping the gun trained on Malachi. Come on, man. Malachi protested, his body beginning to tremble. You don't have to do this. Oh, but I do. I can't stop till the job is done. Malachi's head was spinning, trying to figure out how this was possible. So this whole time it was you? Zaire grinned. Ding, ding, ding. We have a winner. Why, though? What the hell did I ever do to you? Finally, the sinister smile on Zaire's face erased. Because you deserved it. You ain't shit, ain't never been shit, and would never be shit if you were allowed to live. Malachi felt himself beginning to sweat. I'm not following. What is me doing what I did to my girlfriends have to do with you? Now here we go. There was silence between them for a few moments. Malachi didn't dare make a move lest he meet his demise before getting the chance to talk Zaire out of this. You know you didn't deserve Zoe. Zaire finally said, refusing to answer his question, but moving toward Malachi with the gun. She was innocent. Malachi took a step back. I know that. That's why I tried to change. You waited too late. You should have changed before her. You shouldn't have ever fucked around in the first place. Malachi was now against the wall. There was nowhere to run because Zaire had him cornered. Come on, Zaire. Come on, man. We boys. The gunshot sounded, but there was a silencer on the weapon, so no one would hear it. Malachi felt like the wind was knocked out of him as he took a bullet to the chest. He sank to the floor, blood pooling around him as he watched Zaire, who was watching him. He was going to let him bleed out. Zaire stood there for minutes as Malachi grew weaker and weaker. Then he finally walked back over to him and checked his pulse. Oh, my God, and there's a break in the chapter. Listen. I was thinking Erin, yo, and it's his homie. I mean, y'all had said it. I thought it was Ben, because he was the one that seemed angry. Wait. Except for that one time. Wait, was they playing poker? But remember, it was that one time that Zaire was acting weird. Damn. Anyway, it don't fucking matter. We now know. Sorry, that's gonna sound really loud. My bad. I feel like that. There it is. Y'all just heard it. See how long that was from the time it happened to now when it happened. But anyway, who cares? I can't remember what that time was, but I was expecting it to be Ben. So who said, Zaire, who said that? Somebody said that earlier. I'm tripping. All right. Zaire didn't feel anything, so he stood to his feet and prepared to execute the next part of the plan. He walked toward the door, but as soon as he opened it, he was face to face with a gun, the same kind of gun he held in his hands, with the same silencer he'd used to get rid of Malachi once and for all. Zaire swallowed. "Hey, stop playing," he stammered. The Avenger smirked. "Oh, wait, hold on, pause. Yo, so Zaire wasn't the Avenger. He just decided to motherfucking kill what's-her-name, thinking that if he took Malachi out, whoever the Avenger was would stop and not kill him. What the mother... Okay, hold on, let me be quiet. Wait, I need to hit the vape, y'all. I'm tripping. I'm going around in a circle. Oh, my God. The Avenger smirked. Who said it was a game? Zaire stepped backward, finding himself in the same predicament Malachi was just in, despite the fact that he had a gun of his own. You don't have to do this. I love you. The Avenger laughed at that one. Baby, love doesn't exist in this world. Before Zaire could say another word, he was hit with a bullet in the head. He died immediately. The Avenger stood over his body for a moment. Tisk, tisk. I actually did like you, you know? Then they quickly staged the scene to make it look like a murder-suicide before fleeing. Some of a bitch! Wait, it may not have... What if it was a dude, though? It might... Maybe Zaire was gay. Because Zaire... Which... Ben was the one that was married to the chick. What was her name? Chardonnay? Sandra? Something? Amanda? Who? Whatever the whole name was that he was married to. Stacy? Stephanie? Something. So they was working together, but then apparently whoever this person is took him out. I bet you it's LaTanya, y'all. I don't know. Okay, let me be quiet. I gotta get the timestamp. I'm about to pick the book up and just start reading. Hold on, y'all. Oh, Lord Jesus. Okay. Okay, I got the timestamp. So we just gotta wait and let it. Hey, girl, you. Emir talking about, ain't no way, bro. Yeah, it is. Way. Definitely way. Lord, have mercy. Mm-mm. All right. Chapter 41. Alice had a sinking feeling in her gut all that morning, and she knew it was about Malachi. Something wasn't right. She could feel it. Don't you do it, Saki. She'd been praying about her son since before the day he was born, and God had always answered her. He showed her things about Malachi, too, from time to time. Alice felt like God was telling her this morning that she needed to go and see her son. She was making her way around on crutches these days, but she still had a home health aide, Sandra. Sandra, can you bring me to Malachi's apartment, please? Sandra wrinkled her nose. The lazy heifer. Didn't you say he was moving? Alice shot her a stern look. I need to go. Now, Sandra slow poked around, but she got Alice into her van and drove her to her son's house as she requested. The whole way over, the sinking feeling in Alice's stomach grew. Something was wrong. She was sure of it. Alice didn't wait for Sandra to come around to the passenger side to help her out. She kicked the door open with a good leg, grimaced because of the pain she felt in the other one, and got out of the vehicle, making her way on her crutches to her son's front door. It was slightly ajar, so she pushed it open with one of her crutches, then let out a blood-curdling scream. What is it? Sandra said, rushing up behind her. Oh, my God, she said, then whipped out her phone to call the police. The EMTs were there in minutes, along with the police. Alice watched as they assessed her son and his friend Zaire. She prayed with all of her heart that somehow her baby would make it through this. We got a pulse, the EMTs said when they hooked Malachi up to their machine. Lord Jesus, Alice said, and almost fainted from her nervousness. She and Sandra watched as Malachi was rushed away in one ambulance while Zaire was covered in a white sheet and carted off in another. Chartasia rushed through the hospital, holding her son Makai's hand as she raced toward Malachi's room. Her son had no idea what was really going on. All he knew was that his daddy was in the hospital. Chartasia prayed internally that Malachi would make it through. Okay, so we can now eliminate Chartasia, because why would she be praying that he made it through if she was the one who beamed his ass? All right. Alice had said the EMTs told her she'd found him just in time. She finally rounded the corner but stopped in her tracks when she saw Aaron. Shartasia never liked that bitch, not from day one. From the looks of it, according to Aaron, the feeling was mutual. "What are you doing here?" they asked each other in unison. "I came here to see my son's father," Shartasia said, raising her son's hand for emphasis. "Funny you care anything about him now. I would tread lightly if I were you."
"Tread lightly?" Shartasia shot back. "What the hell do you mean, tread lightly?"
Aaron stared down her nose at Shartasia. "We aren't entirely sure you had nothing to do with this."
"And who is we?" Shartasia said. "Why would I do something to hurt Malachi?"
Aaron didn't miss a beat. "We is referring to myself, Malachi, and the police." Shartasia was about to lose her temper.
"Bitch, what the fuck did you—"
Aaron held her hand up. "Excuse me, your son is here. Better hold on to his hand now while you can, because if it's found out you were behind this, your ass is grass. His mother told me Zaire shot him, then killed himself. Guess she didn't let you in on that minor detail."
"Wrong," Aaron spat. "Whoever did this tried to make it look like a murder-suicide, but it wasn't."
"Daddy got shot?" Makai said, his eyes welling with tears. Shartasia was so pissed that Aaron had the nerve to come for her that she'd forgotten her son was with her. "Baby, don't worry. Daddy's gonna be okay."
"Yeah, you'd better hope so," Aaron said to Shartasia, her voice cracking.
Shartasia calmed herself down. Despite her issue with Aaron, she knew the woman obviously cared for Malachi. Shartasia did, too, in her own way.
"Look, Aaron, I would never have anything to do with something like this."
"Yeah? Well, why did you drive by Ben's house the night Leia was murdered?"
Shartasia was confused. "Who the hell is Leia?"
Just then, Alice came around the corner on her crutches.
"Nana!" Makai said and ran to her.
Alice took him around the corner to the family waiting room while Shartasia and Aaron continued their conversation. Aaron's eyes narrowed. "You can't sit there and lie and say you have no idea who Leia was."
Shartasia racked her brains.
"No, I don't. The woman who was murdered by my ex-boyfriend Banks?"
Realization dawned.
"Oh yeah, I remember that. But what the fuck does that have to do with me?"
Malachi said.
"Never mind." Aaron looked like she realized she had said too much. Shartasia easily put two and two together. Malachi was involved with Leia, wasn't he? Then he went to Ben's house and saw me. Then somehow he connected in his mind that I killed his little side bitch.
"You gotta be dumber than I thought, Aaron. If I'm so guilty, why haven't the police reached out to me?"
It was Aaron's turn to look confused.
"They haven't?"
Malachi said. Both women stared at each other. Something was off about this story, and if and when Malachi pulled through, he was gonna have to figure it out.
"So wait,
Malachi told you that I was questioned by police?"
"Yes, he said they ruled you out as a suspect.
But that's crazy because I've never been contacted."
"Why would the officer lie about that?"
Aaron was becoming confused. Shartasia could tell. "This means that whoever did this is still out there," Shartasia said.
"What were you doing by Ben's house that night?" Aaron asked.
"Honestly, I don't even know what night it was, but regardless of that, my man lives near Ben's house."
Aaron's jaw dropped. "Yo, man?"
"Yes, my man. I haven't told Malachi about it yet, but I'm dating Makai's teacher."
"Damn," was Aaron's reply, but she didn't comment further.
Shartasia knew it probably wasn't the wisest decision, but Mr. Martin, Makai's teacher, had been a complete gentleman about the whole thing. Their interaction started with them talking about how Makai was doing with his schoolwork. Then, somewhere along the way, it segued into something more. He swept Shartasia off her feet because Tayshawn Martin was everything Malachi had never been. He and Shartasia were keeping things under wraps until Makai finished out the school year, but Shartasia loved the way things were going. She finally felt like she'd met the right man. And that's the end of that chapter.
Listen, goddammit, I'm confused as fuck. This is stupid. Damn, I don't know what's going on. I am so annoyed. I don't even know what to say. Hold on, y'all. Oh, okay. Sorry. Got some more books here. Hold on, y'all. Just one second. Now, what's funny to me is the ones that we need to complete the fucking you dig for the Easy Rollins thing, can't get them. Oh, let me see. All right, here we go. Now let me get my timestamp and then we can boogie on down the road. Y'all, we it's only 37 minutes left in the book. We almost fintish. Almost fintish. Calm down, Charlie. All right, let me see. What the hell is this here? Okay, got it. We're just gonna let that count on down. Yep. No, Ben's still alive. But he useless. Because he in the hospital. So, yeah, but that's it. Chapter 42. Erin was distraught. She and Alice were forced by hospital personnel to leave after visiting hours were over, or she would have stayed by Malachi's bed all night. Now, look what happened. She and Alice had gone to see him this morning. The doctors had been able to stabilize him and remove the bullet the night before. Just when Erin thought everything was going to be all right, things took a turn for the worse. I'm sorry, ma'am, but it's an ongoing investigation, the nurse said. They refused to give them more information about Malachi or to allow them to see him. Ongoing investigation, my behind. You let me in there to see my son now. The nurse's face flushed at Alice's reprimand. Ma'am, she said in a low voice. She looked back and forth from Alice to Erin. Look, I'm not supposed to tell you this. The detectives are on their way, but your son isn't here. He isn't here, Alice and Erin exclaimed together. The nurse raised her hand to quiet them, then nodded. He disappeared at some point last night. We believe he was kidnapped. Alice let out a wounded cry. Oh, Lord, my baby. Just then, two officers came around the corner. Alice Waters, one of them said. Reynolds, Erin read from her badge. Yes, Alice answered. We need to speak with you about your son. Officer Reynolds turned to Erin. Ma'am, may we have a moment? Alice spoke before Erin could open her mouth. No, she's family. She can be here. Okay, well, I have to let you know that this is an ongoing investigation, but Malachi is missing. We have reason to believe he was kidnapped from his room. Kidnapped from his room? Alice said, pretending to be surprised. Erin reasoned because she didn't want to get the nurse who told them the news initially in trouble. Erin acted surprised right along with her. Why would someone kidnap him? She asked. We don't know, Officer Reynolds answered. Do you know anyone who could have done this? The only person Erin could think of was Banks, but he was still locked up as he awaited trial. From the looks of it, Alice was drawing blanks too. Officer, I'm sorry, I don't know. Wait, is it maybe the Avenger, one of his siblings? Right? I just thought about that, right? It's a break in the fucking chapter. So Buck said this book started off crawling and it ended up in a full-blown sprint, right? Girl, listen, okay? Parent teacher meet up is more like it. Not meeting, meet up, honey. Parent teacher hookup. That's what it is, child. Oh my God, here we go. The Avenger listened to music on their headphones as they sipped on wine in the private jet. The private jet? What the entire fuck? Okay. Their flight was to an undisclosed location. Thankfully, Malachi was healing pretty well from his gunshot wound, so the Avenger could take it from here. They smiled, then turned up. Jasmine Sullivan's Bust Your Windows, nodding their head and snapping their fingers to the beat. Malachi stirred and moaned in his gurney, but didn't wake up. Shh, the Avenger soothed. You'll be all better soon. Then the real games will begin. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, what the fuck, yo? Oh, hey, Michi, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you, darling. You're going to have to red ball it back, child, because you later than late. We almost finished. All right, not with my talking ass. We ain't almost finished, but we're going to hurry up, though, because it's really only 35 minutes left in the book, child. Let me see. Come on, so I... All right,
Got the timestamp. We just waiting.
Oh my God. Y'all, this book, I need a Tokyo tea or two. No, two is too many. Just one. Chapter 43. Completely taken aback by the day's events, Alice and Aaron went to Ben's room to see if he had woken up yet. Sorry. When they got inside, they realized he had. He was surrounded by flowers, balloons, and his family. "Hey, Miss Alice," he said with a smile. Then he looked at Aaron. "What are you two doing here?" Aaron let Alice take the floor. "Ben, I really don't want to trouble you with this, but were you aware of everything that was going on with Malachi?" Ben nodded, his smile faltering. "I know he was being followed by someone. Things started getting crazy, then I ended up here. Zaire probably knows more than me, though, because from what my family told me, it's been a few weeks since I've been in my coma. I just woke up a couple of days ago." Aaron and Alice looked at each other, each wondering whether they should tell Ben the news. "Why? What's up?" Ben asked, as if he was picking up on their apprehension. Alice looked at Aaron, then back at Ben. "Don't worry about all that. Just focus on healing." She and Aaron moved to leave. "Wait," Ben said. "Did something happen? Is Malachi okay? Neither he nor Zaire has come by here since I woke up. What's going on?" Alice and Aaron kept walking, trusting that Ben's family would take over and calm him down. Ugh. This is some bullshit. Ugh. I don't even understand, y'all. I don't even know, like, y'all. What the whole hell? I need to know. It's a break in the chapter. Okay, so we know Shartasia and Aaron are eliminated, right? Banks don't know nobody with a private jet, child. Well, we don't know that yet, but we don't think he know nobody like that. He a hood rich nigga, not a rich, rich nigga. That's two totally different things. Yeah. But at this point, I don't even know, like, what is happening? I don't know, like, damn. Because I was trying to flip backwards and see, like, if there were any clues. But at this point, I don't know what's happening. All right. A month went by and Malachi was still missing. Alice, Aaron, and even Ben, once he was released from the hospital, worked tirelessly with the police to figure out what happened to him. No one could figure it out and no leads existed as to who had taken him. As the weeks unfolded, it appeared that the detectives were losing interest in the case. What? How do you lose interest in the case? What the fuck? Can we all have a spot of tea? Hell no. No. All right. Alice, Aaron, and Ben remained persistent, but there wasn't much they could do without the backing of the police. "Lord, please bring my son back home," Alice found herself praying every night. And that's the end of that chapter. Y'all, this is crazy. Oh, my God, my God, my God. Where the hell is Malachi? Fuck Waldo. Free my nigga Malachi. We just need to know what's going on. Damn. You know, Jewel, that's a thought. Huh. You might be on to something, girl. Chapter 44. Malachi woke up in a dark room. He tried to sit up, but realized his legs and arms were chained to a bed. "Shit," he grunted. "Awake, are we?" a voice said from the shadows. It was a female voice, a familiar voice. "What the?" Malachi couldn't believe his ears. She flipped on the light and Malachi swore his eyes were playing tricks on him too. "Surprise," Zoe said, smiling and twirling around. "Back from the dead," she curtsied. "Did you miss me?" "Zoe, what the fuck? I thought you were dead." "Well, I'm not, silly." "Where am I? Why am I chained to this bed? Baby, you gotta get me out of here." Malachi didn't like the look Zoe was giving him. It was a sinister look, like she had no intentions of letting him out of his chains anytime soon. She chuckled. "Oh, Malachi, if you ever thought I would let you out of this room alive,
at least. You must have lost your motherfucking mind. Malachi had never been more confused in his life. He thought Zaire had thrown him for a loop, and now Zoe? Wait, so you were working with Zaire? Why? How? Zoe flipped her hand like it was no big deal. More like he was working with me. I had my eyes on you for quite a while, Malachi. Once I found out about your indiscretions, it was very hard to keep things going without you finding out about my plans. Finding out? Why would you do this to me? Zoe stared at him like he was dumb. Why wouldn't I? Zoe, I never meant to hurt you. Oh, yeah? Why did you cheat on me barely a year into our relationship then? Malachi fell silent. Yeah, that's right. I knew from the very first moment when you cheated, Malachi. You came home acting different, and I knew some bullshit had gone down. It was Chartasia that time. Then you had the audacity to start fucking Aaron, too. I started planning then, but once you approached Leia, I sped things up a little. Malachi felt defeated. So this whole time, you knew? Hell yeah, I knew. I can't believe you thought I'd be so stupid. You might have been used to fucking with bitches who had bricks for brains, but you never should have tried that with me. I told you from the beginning, I wasn't the one. Malachi remembered that conversation. It was way back when he and Zoe started getting serious. She asked about Chartasia, and he told her she was the mother of his child and nothing more. She later asked about Aaron, and he said they were friends. She'd warned him, telling him that if she ever found out anything different, he'd be sorry, but Malachi didn't take it too seriously. Zoe was the sweet, nurturing type. He never thought she'd hurt a fly, and now here they were. How did Zaire factor in? Malachi asked. That part was still confusing to him. Zoe chuckled. Zaire actually approached me one day. You were busy dogging me out, fucking Aaron at the hotel on 6th Avenue. I was distraught, and Zaire came over looking for you. He saw that I'd been crying, and we talked. Malachi froze. You and Zaire were fucking? Zoe waved her hand. Of course not. I mean, I told him it would happen eventually, but first I had a few things I needed him to help me with. I played the damsel in distress, and he fell right in line. That nigga really betrayed me over a... Malachi stopped himself. He remembered he was still chained to a bed, and Zoe was still very much in power. It turns out Zaire never liked you too much anyway. He told me you'd been arrogant since you were a kid. You never let him or Ben shine, fucking every female before either of them had a chance. He told me you had what I had planned. No, he told me you had what I had planned coming to you a long time ago. Oh, okay. That was confusing me a little bit. But that's not true. Zoe cut him off. That's neither here nor there now because Zaire's dead. Remember, I took care of him. The cold look she was giving him caused chills down Malachi's spine. Malachi tried a last-ditch effort. Zoe, wait, what about our baby? Our baby? She laughed in his face until he finally put two and two together that she lied about being pregnant. Malachi tried again. Zoe, I swear, if you let me go. She held her hand up to stop his plea. Malachi, I am never letting you go. What's that quote your mother always told you? Keep playing with fire and you'll be burned. Well, it's time to burn, baby. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, goddammit. Ooh, chile, chile. Child, I am tripping. Lord, Lord, Lord. But the body was supposed to be burned beyond recognition anyway. Uh-huh. It wasn't an open casket. Yeah, she was burned beyond recognition. It was a closed casket, so it didn't matter. But yeah, she faked that shit. I am tripping. That is crazy. All right. I am, y'all do not even realize. You cannot be around here fucking, you know, mistreating bitches because you fuck around and you find out. Damn. And here we are. We thinking everybody but Zoe. I'm like, she's a dingbat. She's a good woman, Savannah. Man. And it's her. But yeah, her cornbread clearly is not done.
That's gotta be. We don't know who burned up in the car, child, Jewel. Some dead body she got. Chapter 45, Zoe let Malachi sit with her comment about him burning for the next few days, only coming into the underground shed where he was being held to feed him and change him like he was a damn baby. She'd stripped him of his pants and shirt and put a big-ass adult-sized diaper on him to humiliate him. There wasn't anything Malachi could do because the chains and cuffs were too thick to break. Zoe refused to speak to him. He asked her question after question, but everything fell on deaf ears. She was really planning on keeping him here, wherever here was, forever. He could tell. And there's another break in the chapter. Lord. Malachi woke one morning to Zoe's lips around his pulsing member. He used to love when she woke him up this way. Now it made him sick to his stomach despite his erection. She kept going till he almost climaxed. Then she got on top of him and began to ride. It was then that he noticed she was naked from the waist down. Yes, baby, right there, she moaned. She continued to moan and scream his name at the top of her lungs until she climaxed, then collapsed on top of him. Damn, she said when she caught her breath. You always were good in bed. Malachi smelled something burning nearby. Zoe, what are you doing? She stared into his eyes. You'll see. Malachi didn't like the sound of this. He prayed that whatever she had planned, it was nothing too crazy. That prayer halted when he saw the branding iron. Isn't it cute? I had one made for each of us. Zoe, what the hell are you? She approached him with the iron. He could make out the letter Z at the top of it. No, please, he yelled, but it was no use. Zoe's signature sinister smile was displayed across her face, her missing back tooth also evident. She was definitely about to do this to him. Don't be scared, silly. The world needs to know we belong to each other. She held the iron near his penis. No, 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 please, Malachi screamed at the top of his lungs, causing her to laugh hysterically. Oh, no, won't be doing that, she winked. Then she pulled the neck of her t-shirt down and to the side so he could see the fresh M that was branded on her chest. See, baby, one for me and one for you. Then she held the iron close to his chest. Be still. This might sting a little. Zoe, no! Zoe, no! Malachi screamed. Then the room was filled with his continual cries as Zoe laughed and branded him with the iron. Damn! Insane in the membrane. Wow, there's another break in the chapter. I am tripping, yo. She done branded his ass. Going insane, ain't got no brain. Y'all, the shit we used to dance to, that used to be my shit. Hey. Oh, yo, I am tripping. This is crazy. Yeah, this is very different from the usual books we read over here. All right, here we go. Hold on. All right. The next week played out the exact same way every day. Zoe would come down into the shed, check on Malachi's burn, ride him until she was satisfied, then leave him alone, only returning once a day to feed him and give him water. He pissed and shitted in his diapers, and she'd clean him up every morning before beginning her ritual, ending it with another fresh diaper. Malachi didn't know whether he wanted to survive this. He thought about his son, his mother, Ben, and Aaron. He wondered if Ben had woken up by now or if what Zoe had done had killed him. He was still fuzzy on the details of exactly which acts were committed by his former best friend or his ex, but he later surmised it didn't matter. If Ben was dead, it was all his fault. He knew his mother and Aaron had to be worried about him, not to mention Makai. His heart longed for his son. Malachi felt as if fate was slapping him in the face with the reality that Makai might grow up without a father after all. He'd wasted so much time bullshitting that he should have spent raising him. Now he might never get the chance. Day and night, he lamented over his life's decisions, praying to God for another chance. He wished there was a way he could send out a signal to let someone know where he was. Only he had no idea where Zoe had taken him.
He could be on a deserted island for all he knew, except she was keeping him in an underground shed. That clued him in on the possibility that he might still be in the U.S., at least. Still, he had no way of knowing. Lord, please, he begged each night that he lay there alone, swimming in his own feces and urine. Please get me out of here. And that's the end of that chapter. Wait a minute. Shut up, wifey. You wrong for that. Amir said the author must have some psychological issues to be publishing stuff like this. Me either, Jewel. Listen, I draw the line at that. Even if you got to leave a nigga with one hand free so he can handle his thug thizzle, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, I dump a bin, but, you know, a potty chair, but I ain't about to be wiping your ass with baby wipes and shit, bro. Because, yeah. Let me tell you something. Oh, Lord. Mm-mm. Not just to keep you there, I'm saying. You know, it's one thing if you sick, you know, then you do what you got to fucking do. But, bro, I ain't going to put you in a predicament where I'm the one responsible for cleaning your ass. Because, yeah, no, I ain't going to be able to damn do it. That's the reason why I focused on the mind. I don't even want to smell it. You heard me? No, God. Mm-mm. Nope. Hell no. All right. Let me see. I got my timestamp, so we're going to let it count down. Not long at all. Chapter 46. Oh, turn back around, thing. Sorry, it went sideways. This fucking thing is dumb. Okay, I need to lock my screen. That's what I need to do. My bad. Banks's trial was finally over. Erin had been scared shitless while testifying, but she'd answered all the questions correctly with her mother, Sandy, Ben's girlfriend, Jasmine, and Malachi's mother, Alice, present in the courtroom to encourage her. Erin was truly grateful for their support, but the real burden was lifted from her shoulders when Banks was found guilty of Leah's murder. He walked stone-faced from the courtroom after the verdict. His sentencing would be in another month. Erin went home to change, then put on some sunglasses, a hoodie, and some large sweatpants to head to Starbucks for a coffee. It was her first official day as a free woman, but she wasn't sure whether Banks's boys would retaliate now that she'd testified. She sat at her table alone, lost in thought about what her next move would be, when she heard something that chilled her to the bone. There were two people at the table behind her, and one of their voices sounded familiar. Erin almost turned around to greet the person until she heard what they had to say. We gotta make this quick. I don't want us being seen in public like this together. Shit's getting hot, the first person, a woman, was saying. I know, Sabrina, but what do you want me to do? Jessica, they're asking about that Jane Doe from the morgue. I told you this shit would come back to bite us. They were speaking in hushed tones, but Erin always had what others described as bionic hearing. She listened on. Listen, Jessica said, sounding like she was leaning forward. Erin already had the video camera on her phone recording, and she had it pointed at an angle where she could see Officer Reynolds, the woman who'd approached her, and Alice at the hospital, talking to another woman without realizing she was being recorded. Listen. Officer Jessica Reynolds repeated, Zoe is gone. She's not coming back. Our job was done when we helped her load Malachi onto that jet. Erin scrunched her face up. Zoe, she said under her breath. She thought Zoe was dead. She helped Malachi mourn her. Zoe was behind everything that happened? Erin continued to listen, making sure her camera was still recording. Sabrina wasn't letting up. I know she's not coming back, Jessica, but that still doesn't put us in the clear. They're not going to stop asking about the Jane Doe. We should have known it was a stupid idea. Erin's memory was fuzzy on the details, but she remembered reading in the paper that Zoe died in the rollover accident, where her body was burned beyond recognition, only it apparently wasn't her, seeing that the officer and this other woman were talking about a cover-up. We'll replace her with another body, Officer Reynolds suggested. And then what? What if they ask about the next Jane Doe? I'm telling you, this shit isn't gonna work. We're gonna get caught. I'm thinking of turning myself in. No, don't do that. Hold on. How about this? Aaron continued recording as Officer Reynolds developed a new plan to make the Jane Doe case that their superiors were asking about disappear. Once their conversation was finished, Aaron stopped recording the video, saved it to her cloud, and stood walking from her table to theirs, dragging her chair with her. She pulled back her hoodie and removed her sunglasses, staring Officer Reynolds straight in the eyes. Your little plan sounded great, but here's what we're really gonna do. And that's the end of that chapter. Yeah, because Zoe's daddy is fucking connected. But who the fuck is Sabrina? Apparently, Sabrina is the other female cop, the second female cop. This is like all of the good shit is happening at the end. They should have wrapped up all the killing and drilling and shit in the first 15 chapters so we could learn about how all the rest of this shit is connected. Now everything just feels so goddamn rushed. Like, I'm like, oh, you just putting a nice, neat little bow on it. I need all of the shit. I need the meat of it all. When did y'all plan this shit? And why the fuck did these people feel like it was okay for them to come to you and that you were willing to be paid to do their dirty work? How did they know that? How long you been knowing this motherfucker? Y'all related? Y'all homies? Went to grammar school together? Like, y'all go to the same church? Like, I need to know what's the connection. You know? I need to know the nexus of connection. That's what I need to know. Okay. Let me get my timestamp. Now that I put that out there, maybe we'll get our questions answered. So I have my timestamp, and now I guess we're about to see. Oh, Lord. Right. She getting ready to get everybody back because this is some shit here. All right. Here we go. Chapter 47. Erin didn't know if this was the dumbest idea she'd ever come up with or the smartest, but she had to do what she could to save Malachi. She was equipped with a gun and two one-way plane tickets back home, one for her and one for Malachi. Zoe had taken him to some random ranch in California. They lived in a small town in Massachusetts, so Erin had a tough time finding Zoe's exact location. Erin was staying in a hotel a few miles away and traveling to Zoe's location for most of each day. Wait, what? Once she found her, she watched her for a few days. She figured out rather quickly that Zoe must have been hiding Malachi in an underground shed she kept going to. Erin wanted to alert the local police, but she was afraid of what might happen if Zoe had police ties in California, too. She had to, right? Or why else would she have brought Malachi here? After a few days of watching Zoe, Erin had a plan in place. Zoe left the shed and the ranch every day for about an hour's time. That was plenty of opportunity for Erin to swoop in, take Malachi, and be long gone before she could come back. Erin prayed he was still alive, though she knew in her heart that he had to be. She hadn't told anyone where she was going, including her mother, Alice, or Ben. She knew they would either want to come with her or would try to get her to call the police. Erin wanted to do neither. She hoped her plan would work. Yeah, otherwise she gonna die and ain't nobody gonna know who in the fuck she is. Finally, it was showtime. Zoe left like clockwork and Erin waited until her car was gone for a few minutes. She couldn't chance her doubling back because she forgot something. Erin approached the shed and, of course, the doors were locked. She shot the lock off and thankfully hit it on her first try. Then she opened the shed and walked down the steps, not sure what she'd find down there. The sight before her was heartbreaking. The room smelled like feces, urine, and gasoline. Malachi was chained to a bed wearing a ridiculous-looking adult diaper, and there were other diapers with flies swarming around them, tossed in a corner. Erin wrinkled her nose in disgust. Malachi's mouth was duct-taped shut, but he was trying to tell her something. She walked over and ripped it from his lips. "Erin," he panted, his voice frantic. "You gotta get out of here." "What do you mean?" "Zoe's..." "Oh, Erin." The blood drained from Erin's face as she heard Zoe's voice from outside the shed. Zoe peered down at them, lit match in hand. "Did you honestly think I wouldn't notice you watching me? Homegirl, please, you gotta be slicker than that. Plus, my friends ain't no fools. As you may know, we've figured out how to cover up a body or two. Zoe, please, Zoe," Malachi screamed. "Fuck you," Zoe said back to him, then turned to Erin. "As for you, Go ahead and die with this cheating ass nigga, you stupid bitch. Zoe threw the match down into the shed, then closed its doors. The room immediately began to catch fire because of the gasoline Zoe had poured throughout it. They didn't have much time. Malachi was still chained up, but there was an axe laying nearby. Aaron quickly put her gun in her waistband and grabbed the axe, swinging with all her might to break Malachi's chains. Thankfully, she got all four of his limbs free on her first tries, but the room was filling rapidly with smoke and fire. She ripped off her shirt and gave Malachi a piece to cover his face with. Then she covered her own. Malachi went first up the steps to the door of the shed while Aaron followed. Malachi got outside, then turned to extend his hand to help Aaron out. Then he was hit in the back of the head with a shovel and crumpled to the ground. Aaron raced out of the shed, gun back in her hands. Zoe looked surprised to see she had a weapon. "Those dirty bitches," she said, likely referring to Officer Reynolds and Sabrina Rogers, the medical examiner. That's where she got the body from. Okay, gotcha. Aaron had no problem shooting the lock off the shed door, but she didn't know if she had it in her to shoot a human being. Zoe must have sensed this because she rushed toward Aaron with the shovel. Aaron squeezed her eyes shut and pulled the trigger. The bullet hit Zoe's shoulder, causing her to drop the shovel, but she still lunged at Aaron, causing her to step back and trip over a rock, dropping the gun in the process. Zoe kicked her a few times in the back and stomach, knocking the wind out of her. Then she went for the gun, only to find that Malachi was pointing it at her. At some point during their scuffle, he must have woken up. "Yeah, what now, bitch?" he said with menace in his tone. Zoe looked unafraid. "You mean you gonna shoot me after everything I've done for you?" "Freeze!" Malachi and Zoe both jumped, and Aaron whipped her head around to see two police officers coming toward them, guns drawn. The three of them were arrested and brought to the station for questioning. And that's the end of the chapter. Why are the police there? I thought, who called the police? Maybe they heard the gunshot of her shooting the lock off to the underground shed. I don't know, but let me read, y'all. Hold on. Gotta get the next timestamp. All right, I got my timestamp. I need to wet my whistle, child. Oh, that's good. That's coffee. Chapter 48. The next few months went by like a blur. After hours of questioning plus Aaron's supplying of the evidence, she and Malachi were released and allowed to go home. There was a battle between police departments over who had the most jurisdiction over the crime, since Zoe and her accomplices had committed crimes in both Massachusetts and California. In the end, they decided to split it, with the kidnapping and attempted murder cases being handled in Cali and the murder and conspiracy cases being held in Massachusetts. Either way, in Malachi's eyes, Zoe was going down. That was until Zoe's parents stepped in and provided her with a high-profile attorney who built up an insanity defense. Suddenly, Aaron, Ben, Alice, and Malachi's testimonies didn't mean shit. They didn't have the money or power Xander and Zelda held. That part don't matter. Like, that part don't even matter. Anyway, it's a break in the chapter. This is some bullshit. One thing ain't got a goddamn thing to do with the motherfucking other. Girl, don't get me all hype and shit. See, they should have just beamed her ass. Fuck. While he talking about, "Yeah, what now, bitch?" You should have just blasted this hole. The trials went on for 2 years. Malachi watched and listened in horror as one by one every piece of critical information tying Zoe to any of her crimes was deemed inadmissible. It made him sick to his stomach that her parents had hired such a high-powered attorney who could make her insanity case seem solid. Her accomplices didn't fare as well. Both were sentenced to 10 years in prison for their crimes. Finally, after a series of continuances brought about by Zoe's lawyer, the jury was ready to read their verdict. Their deliberations lasted over a week, and Malachi's heart sank more each day. In the end, the jury was convinced that Zoe was mentally unstable at the times of the crimes that she was tied to. All she got was a sentencing of 7 years in a psychiatric hospital. Then she'd be reevaluated for possible release. Malachi didn't know what to make of the sentencing because it potentially meant that Zoe would be a thorn in his side for the rest of his life. He decided not to dwell on it, focusing on self-healing, his son, and his job, which he miraculously still held despite his attendance issues. Now, how in the fuck is that even possible? It's another break in the chapter. We're zooming ahead years. That was the hot mix version. This is crazy. I'm just like, what the fuck? Oh my God. I need a fucking second. The trial went on for 2 years and what? Y'all gonna have to make this bullshit make motherfucking sense to me because I ain't, the sense ain't sensing. God damn it, Kathleen. But it does fit. I mean, we get that the bitch is crazy, but she knew what the fuck she was doing. Hell, she was in cahoots with the goddamn police. And why they each only get 10 years? That's some bullshit. Hell. You fucking conspiring with a whole fucking Looney Tunes ass bitch. Anyway, Malachi spent the next few years keeping his promises. He attended every event at Mackay School, regardless of how big or small it was. He was there so much Shartasia started missing an event or two because she knew her son was good. Mackay and Malachi's relationship blossomed. They were the best buddies, and Malachi spent every moment he could showering his son with the love, affection, and guidance he longed for as a child, but never received from his own father. Malachi was beyond proud of his son, who became the reigning champion of the competition at the robotics camp he'd attended each summer for the past 3 years. Mackay was just hitting his teen years and had aspirations of becoming a mechanical engineer. When he shared that with his father, the first person he told, Malachi broke down in tears. To think that their relationship had changed so much that he was the person who had the honor of being the first to be informed of such a dream, Malachi would never forget that moment. As another part of his transformation, Malachi also was ignoring advances from women left and right. He joined his mother's church and even sang in the men's choir with Ben, who was studying to become a minister. At first, Ben gave him a side eye about his claims of abstinence and commitment to singlehood for the purpose of growth and healing. But when Ben saw Malachi turn down women right in front of him, he knew his friend had changed. Wow, Malachi. He commented one day after Malachi turned down a woman who tried to give him her number. Don't you think it's a little extreme to not even date? Malachi shook his head. Nah, man, I'm on a good path right now, and I'm not letting anything or anyone steer me wrong. I messed up on my priorities for so long. I'm not letting my son or my mom or myself down any longer. Ben gave him a strange look, but left the matter alone. Malachi had said those words to his best friend with a straight face, and he meant them. But deep down in his heart, part of the real reason he hadn't gone after or accepted any advances from any woman was because his heart was still set on Erin. She wasn't giving him the time of day, romantically at least, but he held out hope that one day she too would see his change. Malachi couldn't be more proud of his tremendous growth in such a short time frame, though the shame never left him concerning exactly what it took for him to make such a change, nor did the fear that Zoe could potentially come back after him after she was released from the hospital. And that's the end of that chapter. Yeah, out in 7, not to put him back on the depends, right, in the same city. Ciao. A absolute fucking mess. All right, let me get the, I don't even care anymore. Like, this shit ain't making sense. Okay. Like, you rushing me through the end and putting a little neat little bow on everything. Anyway, it don't matter. 5 seconds. Chapter 29. Not 29. Chapter 49. God damn it, Kathleen. Another year later, and Ben and Jasmine's relationship had blossomed to the point of marriage. Malachi was happy for his friend, despite his own abstinence journey. He'd held out hope for a long time that he and Aaron could rekindle something, seeing that she was the one who got away, but she finally broke down and told him they shared too much trauma to have a healthy relationship. It broke Malachi's heart to hear that, but he knew it was for the best. They remained friends, though. Malachi started hearing less from her after she met a new man and got engaged to him. Shartasia was also married now to Makai's teacher, Mr. Martin. First, Malachi was disgusted, but one look from Shartasia was all it took for him to drop his arguments. He'd put her through his bullshit for years, so who was he to disturb her happiness? Besides, Tayshaun turned out to be a cool dude. He never tried to overstep and take Malachi's place in his role as Makai's stepfather, so Malachi let it go. Malachi spent his days feeling fulfilled, but his nights were pretty lonely. And there's a break in the chapter, so he just gotta beat his meat. Stick to beating his meat. Hey, beat his meat. Stretch and beat his meat. It's a video on YouTube from a dormtainment. I think it's called Don't Act. Right, like Don't Act. It's either Don't Act or Girl Come On. But just fucking search that. It's from Dormtainment. When I tell you that fucking shit is funny, yo, if you go watch it, pay attention to the dude in the khaki pants with the blue or navy blue polo shirt. It looks navy blue to me. I done been watching that thing for years. It's been up on YouTube for years, right? It is fucking hilarious. And the music is to one of the Whispers songs from back in the day. Just find it. Dormtainment, like a college dormtainment. That's the name of the channel, Dormtainment. All right. 6 months later, and Aaron's wedding day was here. Malachi fought back and forth about whether he should go to support her, seeing that they had become very close friends after everything that happened. But in the end, he decided against it. He didn't know if he still had some selfish tendencies that lingered or what, but he couldn't bring himself to see the woman he loved marry another man. He prayed she would understand. Malachi stayed at home with a case of beers and resolved in his mind that he would drink himself to oblivion to take his mind off of things. He was halfway through the case when a knock sounded at his front door. Shit, who's that? He slurred, stumbling toward it. He opened it, and it was Aaron, looking nervous as the day she was born. What are you doing here? He asked, feeling confused. Malachi, I couldn't do it. Her eyes welled up and her body started trembling. Malachi let her in and closed the door, trying to wrap his mind around what she was saying. What do you mean you couldn't do it? I thought you were in love. She looked away. That's what I told myself. But Malachi, there's only one man who's truly held my heart. That man is you. Those words hit Malachi like a thump in the chest. All those nights he spent praying, all those days he cried tears of grief over what could have been. Here Aaron was, standing before him, iterating the real-life version of his wildest dreams. Aaron, are you sure? I mean, I'm sure. She nodded. I don't want anybody else but you. Her lower lip trembled and she began to cry. Malachi cried with her. Then he held her in his arms. And that's the end of the book. Epilogue. Malachi and Aaron were married within 30 days. Malachi decided to go all out and splurge on whatever Aaron wanted for the wedding. They had gone through so much, both individually and as a couple, that he wanted Aaron to truly feel special on the day she became his bride. Thankfully for his pockets, Aaron didn't want much. They had a very small wedding party with Ben as the best man and Jasmine as the maid of honor. Their mothers, Alice and Sandy, walked Aaron down the aisle to give Aaron away. Since Aaron's father wasn't in her life like Marcus wasn't in Malachi's, Aaron's father, Jared, was still around, but Aaron hadn't spoken to him since childhood, so she didn't bother to invite him to her nuptials. Shit, that's crazy. Anyway, Alice and Sandy both had new men in their lives now, too. And Aaron and Malachi couldn't be happier for their mothers. There wasn't a dry eye in the room as Malachi and Aaron recited their handwritten vows to one another. No one doubted that the vows would be fulfilled after everything they had gone through together. At the reception, they danced the night away. Then they spent a 2-week honeymoon in the Bahamas. That was where Aaron splurged on Malachi's money. He enjoyed every moment of it, sparing no expense for his woman. She deserved it. And there's a break in the epilogue. How the fuck does the epilogue have a break, girl? Come on, Tanisha. All right, here we go. When Malachi and Aaron returned from their honeymoon, they moved into Aaron's apartment since it was bigger than the one Malachi moved into after leaving him in Zoe's old place. They planned to start saving for a house soon, but first they wanted to enjoy their time together as a couple who had truly weathered the storm. They stayed up half the night writing out thank you cards and opening wedding gifts from various members of their church until Aaron stumbled upon a plain white box that had no card or label on it to determine who it was from. Ugh, she said, rolling her eyes and wrinkling her nose. I hate when people do this. How are we supposed to properly thank them? Malachi chuckled as he was barely paying attention, checking out his new golden cufflinks the pastor of the church had bought him. They had his diamond-encrusted initials on them. He was about to be looking sharp. Malachi opened his mouth to say something to Aaron when he froze. She opened the box and it contained a single black rose. What's this? She asked and looked at her husband, who appeared to be transported back in time. Malachi, she said, trying to get his attention. Malachi fought to control his breathing. This couldn't be happening. Zoe wasn't set to be out for another 2 years or so. He didn't want to deal with this right now. Zoe, was all he said. Aaron paused. Are you sure? He nodded. She's the only one who could have done this. The next morning, they called the police to report the incident, but of course, there was no way to trace it back to Zoe. Malachi's nerves were on edge for the next month or so, but he let it go when he saw that there was no further action. And there's another break in the fucking epilogue. Oh my God. Okay. Another year passed, and Malachi and Aaron welcomed their baby girl. Alice joked that they were silly for starting over with Makai in his sophomore year of high school. Don't you dare ask me to babysit, she teased. Sandy wore the same expression as she looked at Aaron. Girl, me either. Then they shared a laugh because both mothers knew they couldn't wait to get their hands on that precious little girl, Alisa, whose name was a combination of both of their names. And there's another break in the damn thing. Zoe was finally released from the psychiatric facility. It had been 8 long years, but she'd had a few hiccups around her 3rd or 4th year. She was happy to finally be a free woman. It got tiring after a while, being monitored practically 24/7 like she wasn't a grown-ass woman. But that was neither here nor there. She'd be quiet for a while. Then she had moves to make. She laid low for a minute. Then it was finally time. Zoe could hardly wait. She carefully sealed the crisp white envelope with a gloved hand so it couldn't be traced back to her, then paid her contact to deliver it to the defense attorney of Alexander Murray, aka Banks. She was sure he'd be grateful for the surprise. All right. All right. So then it says the end. Dear reader, Malachi joined the church and changed his life, but it looks like Zoe is still on the move. Many would argue that he deserved everything he got and more because of his heinous actions. What about a person who did nothing to cause trouble for anyone else, yet someone still has a sinister plan against them? How do you overcome an enemy you don't see coming? Find out in Not What It Seems, a Christian romance thriller. Okay. I don't know what the fuck Not What It Seems is about. Thank you. You too. All right. Sorry. Hold on.
Let me see here. Oh, he trying to. Oh, he got it. Okay. Let's see. I don't think that this is actually part two to this. Listen, I don't know. Girl, what we not finna do is this. What did she say the name of this shit was at the end? Hold on, let me go back. Not what it seems. Okay. Let me see if I can get to it. Hold on. Hold on, y'all. I'm trying to see if boom. All right, let me read the synopsis for this thing, because I didn't think this thing had a, you dig. Hell. Let me get. Okay, so this whole thing says, no, it don't. It don't. It's not. Yeah, this is a different, it seemed like this is a different thing. And I don't know if I want a Christian romance thriller. Yeah, I don't want this. Buck, I'm a okay. I'm trying to see. Yeah, I don't think I need any of this. This book ain't it for me. I'm already itching about it, just that quick. It's making me itch. I'm just itching. Okay, so. Do. All right, so Hey, Miss Pretty. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Okay, so I think, I was thinking about this this Brandon Massey book. What did y'all think? I think I read the synopsis of this one. Where the fuck is the synopsis? Wait a minute. Girl, why it ain't giving me the synopsis of this book? That is crazy. There's no synopsis, y'all. And this book got like 76 chapters, bro. But there's no, hold on. Damn, man. Okay, hold on. Let me see. Let me go up here. All right, let's see if it gives us a synopsis. Okay, here it is. All right. Every woman's temptation.
He can capture your attention just by listening. He wants to know who you really are and fulfill your most secret, forbidden desires. He can undress you with a whisper, respond to your every wish, every touch, and give satisfaction beyond your hottest dreams. But Kevin Richmond is a man as insatiable as he is successful and driven, and he never imagined that the mysterious woman igniting his fantasies would have secrets worth dying for. One seduction too far. Now, Kevin is the prime suspect for a murder he didn't commit. The only way he can clear his name is to discover the real deal behind his lover's deception and confront his own troubled past. But as he's drawn deeper into a nightmare of lust and betrayal, he'll find that the truth is a tantalizing lie and love the most seductive illusion of all. So, what are y'all thinking? What are y'all thinking? I need to know what you think. Because I don't think, I'm trying to get rid of these ones that are right up in the thing. Y'all so busy talking, y'all ain't said a word, but I gotta remember that y'all are a little bit behind me saying it. I know it's like 10 seconds or whatever, 10 or 12 seconds, but because it's either this or I'm gonna pick something else. But yeah, I don't know. I just gave y'all the synopsis for it. Okay, so wifey said, go ahead with it. Okay. All right, so I think that's where we're going to start. Tomorrow. We're going to start there. Yeah, because otherwise, what are we doing here? All right, so listen. I am gonna let y'all go. Well, thank you, Shakara. Church lady said it's fine. Okay, yeah, I'll figure it out. But I'm gonna let y'all get on up out of here. All right, y'all go forth and have a great evening. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. I truly, truly appreciate y'all, and I hope I left y'all feeling better than you were when you got here. Thank you, Love Jones. I truly appreciate all of your hard work, all right? So y'all be easy, okay? And if you do nothing else, please have a great evening and salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye y'all.